My Life and Work by Henry Ford in collaboration with Samuel Crowther. Chapter 13. Why Be Poor? Poverty springs from a number of sources, the more important of which are controllable. So does special privilege. I think it is entirely feasible to abolish both poverty and special privilege, and there can be no question but that their abolition is desirable. Both are unnatural, but it is work, not law, to which we must look for results. By poverty, I mean the lack of reasonably sufficient food, housing, and clothing for an individual or a family. There will have to be differences in the grades of sustenance. Men are not equal in mentality or in physique. Any plan which starts with the assumption that men are or ought to be equal is unnatural and therefore unworkable. There can be no feasible or desirable process of leveling down. Such a course only promotes poverty by making it universal instead of exceptional, forcing the efficient producer to become inefficient does not make the inefficient producer more efficient. Poverty can be done away with only by plenty, and we have now gone far enough along in the science of production to be able to see, as a natural development, the day when production and distribution will be so scientific that all may have according to ability and industry. The extreme socialists went wide of the mark in their reasoning that industry would inevitably crush the worker. Modern industry is gradually lifting the worker and the world. We only need to know more about planning and methods. The best results can and will be brought about by individual initiative and ingenuity, by intelligent individual leadership. The government, because it is essentially negative, cannot give positive aid to any really constructive program. It can give negative aid by removing obstructions to progress and by ceasing to be a burden upon the community. The underlying causes of poverty, as I can see them, are essentially due to the bad adjustment between production and distribution in both industry and agriculture, between the source of power and its application. The wastes due to lack of adjustment are stupendous. All of these wastes must fall before intelligent leadership consecrated to service. So long as leadership thinks more of money than it does of service, the waste will continue. Waste is prevented by far-sighted, not by short-sighted men. Short-sighted men think first of money. They cannot see waste. They think of service as altruistic instead of as the most practical thing in the world. They cannot get far enough away from the little things to see the big things, to see the biggest thing of all, which is that opportunist production, from a purely money standpoint, is the least profitable. Service can be based upon altruism, but that sort of service is not usually the best. The sentimental trips up the practical. It is not that the industrial enterprises are unable fairly to distribute a share of the wealth which they create. It is simply that the waste is so great that there is not a sufficient share for everyone engaged, notwithstanding the fact that the product is usually sold at so high a price as to restrict its fullest consumption. Take some of the wastes. Take the wastes of power. The Mississippi Valley is without coal. Through its center pour many millions of potential horsepower, the Mississippi River. But if the people by its banks want power or heat, they buy coal that has been hauled hundreds of miles and consequently has to be sold at far above its worth as heat or power. Or if they cannot afford to buy this expensive coal, they go out and cut down trees, thereby depriving themselves of one of the greatest conservers of water power. Until recently, They never thought of the power at hand which, at next to nothing beyond the initial cost, could heat, light, cook, and work for the huge population which that valley is destined to support. The cure of poverty is not in personal economy, but in better production. The thrift and economy ideas have been overworked. The word economy represents a fear. The great and tragic fact of waste is impressed on a mind by some circumstance, usually of a most materialistic kind. There comes a violent reaction against extravagance. The mind catches hold of the idea of economy, but it only flies from a greater to a lesser evil. It does not make the full journey from error to truth. Economy is the rule of half-alive minds. There can be no doubt that it is better than waste. Neither can there be any doubt that it is not as good as use. People who pride themselves on their economy take it as a virtue. But what is more pitiable than a poor, pinched mind spending the rich days and years clutching a few bits of metal? What can be fine about paring the necessities of life to the very quick? We all know economical people who seem to be niggardly even about the amount of air they breathe and the amount of appreciation they will allow themselves to give to anything. They shrivel, body and soul. Economy is waste. It is the waste of the juices of life, the sap of living. For there are two kinds of waste. That of a prodigal who throws his substance away in riotous living, and that of the sluggard who allows his substance to rot from non-use. The rigid economizer is in danger of being classed with the sluggard. Extravagance is usually a reaction from suppression of expenditure. Economy is likely to be a reaction from extravagance. Everything was given us to use. There is no evil from which we suffer that did not come about through misuse. The worst sin we can commit against the things of our common life is to misuse them. Misuse is the wider term. We like to say waste, but waste is only one phase of misuse. All waste is misuse. All misuse is waste. It is possible even to overemphasize the saving habit. It is proper and desirable that everyone have a margin. It is really wasteful not to have one, if you can have one, but it can be overdone. We teach children to save their money. As an attempt to counteract thoughtless and selfish expenditure, that has a value. But it is not positive. It does not lead the child out into the safe and useful avenues of self-expression or self-expenditure. To teach a child to invest and use is better than to teach him to save. Most men who are laboriously saving a few dollars would do better to invest those few dollars, first in themselves and then in some useful work. Eventually, they would have more to save. Young men ought to invest rather than save. They ought to invest in themselves to increase creative value. After they have taken themselves to the peak of usefulness, then will be the time enough to think of laying aside, as a fixed policy, a certain substantial share of income. You are not saving when you prevent yourself from becoming more productive. You are really taking away from your ultimate capital. You are reducing the value of one of nature's investments. The principle of use is the true guide. Use is positive, active, life-giving. Use is alive. Use adds to the sum of good. Personal want may be avoided without changing the general condition. Wage increases, price increases, profit increases, other kinds of increases designed to bring more money here or money there are only attempts of this or that class to get out of the fire, regardless of what may happen to everyone else. There is a foolish belief that if only the money can be gotten, somehow the storm can be weathered. Labor believes that if it can get more wages, it can weather the storm. Capital thinks that if it can get more profits, it can weather the storm. There is a pathetic faith in what money can do. Money is very useful in normal times, but money has no more value than the people put into it by production. And it can be so misused. It can be so superstitiously worshipped as a substitute for real wealth as to destroy its value altogether. The idea persists that there exists an essential conflict between industry and the farm. There is no such conflict. It is nonsense to say that because the cities are overcrowded, everybody ought to go back to the farm. If everybody did so, farming would soon decline as a satisfactory occupation. It is not more sensible for everyone to flock to the manufacturing towns. If the farms be deserted, of what use are manufacturers? A reciprocity can exist between farming and manufacturing. The manufacturer can give the farmer what he needs to be a good farmer, and the farmer and other producers of raw materials can give the manufacturer what he needs to be a good manufacturer. Then, with transportation as a messenger, we shall have a stable and a sound system built on service. If we live in smaller communities, where the tension of living is not so high, and where the products of the fields and gardens can be had without the interference of so many profiteers, there will be little poverty or unrest. Look at this whole matter of seasonal work. Take building as an example of a seasonal trade. What a waste of power it is to allow builders to hibernate through the winter, waiting for the building season to come around. And what an equal waste of skill it is to force experienced artisans who have gone into factories to escape the loss of the winter season to stay in the factory jobs through the building season because they are afraid they may not get their factory places back in the winter. What a waste this all-year system has been. If the farmer could get away from the shop to till his farm in the planting, growing and harvesting seasons, they are only a small part of the year, after all, and if the builder could get away from the shop to ply his useful trade in its season, how much better they would be, and how much more smoothly the world would proceed. Suppose we all moved outdoors every spring and summer and lived the wholesome life of the outdoors for 3 or 4 months. We could not have slack times. The farm has its dull season. That is the time for the farmer to come into the factory and help produce the things he needs to till the farm. The factory also has its dull season. That is the time for the workmen to go out to the land to help produce food. Thus we might take the slack out of work and restore the balance between the artificial and the natural. But not the least benefit would be the more balanced view of life we should thus obtain. The mixing of the arts is not only beneficial in a material way, but it makes for breadth of mind and fairness of judgment. A great deal of our unrest today is the result of narrow, prejudiced judgment. If our work were more diversified, if we saw more sides of life, if we saw how necessary was one factor to another, we should be more balanced. Every man is better for a period of work under the open sky. It is not at all impossible. What is desirable and right is never impossible. It would only mean a little teamwork, a little less attention to greedy ambition, and a little more attention to life. Those who are rich find it desirable to go away for 3 or 4 months a year and dawdle in idleness around some fancy winter or summer resort. The rank and file of the American people would not waste their time that way even if they could. But they would provide the teamwork necessary for an outdoor, seasonal employment. It is hardly possible to doubt that much of the unrest we see about us is a result of unnatural modes of life. Men who do the same thing continuously the year around are shut away from the health of the sun and the spaciousness of the great out-of-doors, are hardly to be blamed if they see matters in a distorted light. And that applies equally to the capitalist and the worker. What is there in life that should hamper normal and wholesome modes of living? And what is there in industry incompatible with all the arts receiving, in their turn, the attention of those qualified to serve them? It may be objected that if the forces of industry were withdrawn from the shops every summer, it would impede production. But we must look at the matter from a universal point of view. We must consider the increased energy of the industrial forces after 3 or 4 months in outdoor work. We must also consider the effect on the cost of living which would result from a general return to the fields. We have, as I indicated in a previous chapter, been working towards this combination of farm and factory, and with entirely satisfactory results. At Northville, not far from Detroit, we have a little factory making valves. It is a little factory, but it makes a great many valves. Both the management and the mechanism of the plant are comparatively simple, because it makes but one thing. We do not have to search for skilled employees. The skill is in the machine. The people of the countryside can work in the plant part of the time and on the farm part of the time, for mechanical farming is not very laborious. The plant power is derived from water. Another plant on a somewhat larger scale is in building at Flat Rock, about 15 miles from Detroit. We have dammed the river. The dam also serves as a bridge for the Detroit, Toledo, and Ironton Railway, which was in need of a new bridge at that point, and a road for the public, all in one construction. We are going to make our glass at this point. The damming of the river gives sufficient water for the floating to us of most of our raw material. It also gives us our power through a hydroelectric plant, and, being well out in the midst of the farming country, there can be no possibility of crowding or any of the ills incident to too great a concentration of population. The men will have plots of ground or farms as well as their jobs in the factory, and these can be scattered over 15 or 20 miles surrounding. For, of course, nowadays, the working man can come to the shop in an automobile. There we shall have the combination of agriculture and industrialism and the entire absence of all the evils of concentration. The belief that an industrial country has to concentrate its industries is not, in my opinion, well founded. That is only a stage in industrial development. As we learn more about manufacturing and learn to make articles with interchangeable parts, then those parts can be made under the best possible conditions. And these best possible conditions, as far as the employees are concerned, are also the best possible conditions from the manufacturing standpoint. One could not put a great plant on a little stream. One can put a small plant on a little stream, and the combination of little plants, each making a single part, will make the whole cheaper than a vast factory would. There are exceptions, as where casting has to be done. In such case, as at River Rouge, we want to combine the making of the metal and the casting of it and also we want to use all of the waste power. This requires a large investment and a considerable force of men in one place. But such combinations are the exception rather than the rule, and there would not be enough of them seriously to interfere with the process of breaking down the concentration of industry. Industry will decentralize. There is no city that would be rebuilt as it is were it destroyed, which fact is in itself a confession of our real estimate of our cities. The city had a place to fill, a work to do. Doubtless, the country places would not have approximated their livableness had it not been for the cities. By crowding together, men have learned some secrets. They would never have learned them alone in the country. Sanitation, lighting, social organization, all these are products of men's experience in the city. But also, every social ailment from which we today suffer originated and centers in the big cities. You will find the smaller communities living along in unison with the seasons, having neither extreme poverty nor wealth, none of the violent plagues of upheave and unrest which afflict our great populations. There is something about a city of a million people which is untamed and threatening. 30 miles away, happy and contented villages read of the ravings of the city. A great city is really a helpless mass. Everything it uses is carried to it. Stop transport and the city stops. It lives off the shelves of stores. The shelves produce nothing. The city cannot feed, clothe, warm, or house itself. City conditions of work and living are so artificial that instincts sometimes rebel against their unnaturalness. And finally, the overhead expense of living or doing business in the great cities is becoming so large as to be unbearable. It places so great a tax upon life that there is no surplus over to live on. The politicians have found it easy to borrow money, and they have borrowed to the limit. Within the last decade, the expense of running every city in the country has tremendously increased. A good part of that expense is for interest upon money borrowed. The money has gone either into non-productive brick, stone, and mortar, or into necessities of city life, such as water supplies and sewage systems, at far above a reasonable cost. The cost of maintaining these works, the cost of keeping in order great masses of people and traffic, is greater than the advantages derived from community life. The modern city has been prodigal. It is today bankrupt, and tomorrow it will cease to be. The provision of a great amount of cheap and convenient power, not all at once, but as it may be used, will do more than anything else to bring about the balancing of life and the cutting of the waste which breeds poverty. There is no single source of power. It may be that generating electricity by a steam plant at the mine mouth will be the most economical method for one community. Hydroelectric power may be the best for another community, but certainly in every community there ought to be a central station to furnish cheap power. It ought to be held as essential as a railway or a water supply, and we could have every great source of power harnessed and working for the common good, were it not that the expense of obtaining capital stands in the way. I think that we shall have to revise some of our notions about capital. Capital that a business makes for itself, that is employed to expand the workman's opportunity and increase his comfort and prosperity, and that is used to give more and more men work, at the same time reducing the cost of service to the public, That sort of capital, even though it be under single control, is not a menace to humanity. It is a working surplus held in trust and daily use for the benefit of all. The holder of such capital can scarcely regard it as a personal reward. No man can view such a surplus as his own, for he did not create it alone. It is the joint product of his whole organization. The owner's idea may have released all the energy and direction, but certainly it did not supply all the energy and direction. Every workman was a partner in the creation. No business can possibly be considered only with reference to today and to the individuals engaged in it. It must have the means to carry on. The best wages ought to be paid. A proper living ought to be assured every participant in the business, no matter what his part. But, for the sake of that business's ability to support those who work in it, a surplus has to be held somewhere. The truly honest manufacturer holds his surplus profits in that trust. Ultimately, it does not matter where this surplus be held, nor who controls it. It is its use that matters. Capital that is not constantly creating more and better jobs is more useless than sand. Capital that is not constantly making conditions of daily labor better and the reward of daily labor more just is not fulfilling its highest function. The highest use of capital is not to make more money, but to make money do more service for the betterment of life. Unless we in our industries are helping to solve the social problem, we are not doing our principal work. We are not fully serving. End of chapter 13. Chapter 14. The Tractor and Power Farming. It is not generally known that our tractor, which we call the Fordson, was put into production about a year before we had intended, because of the Allies' wartime food emergency, and that all of our early production, aside, of course, from the trial and experimental machines, went directly to England. We sent in all 5,000 tractors across the sea in the critical 1917-18 period, when the submarines were busiest. Every one of them arrived safely, and officers of the British government have been good enough to say that, without their aid, England could scarcely have met its food crisis. It was these tractors, run mostly by women, that plowed up the old estates and golf courses and let all England be planted and cultivated without taking away from the fighting man power or crippling the forces in the munitions factories. It came about in this way. The English Food Administration, about the time that we entered the war in 1917, saw that, with the German submarines torpedoing a freighter almost every day, the already low supply of shipping was going to be totally inadequate to carry the American troops across the seas to carry the essential munitions for these troops and the Allies, to carry the food for the fighting forces, and at the same time carry enough food for the home population of England. It was then that they began shipping out of England the wives and families of the colonials and made plans for the growing of crops at home. The situation was a grave one. There were not enough draft animals in all England to plow and cultivate land to raise crops in sufficient volume to make even a dent in the food imports. Power farming was scarcely known, for the English farms were not, before the war, big enough to warrant the purchase of heavy, expensive farm machinery. And especially with agricultural labor so cheap and plentiful. Various concerns in England made tractors, but they were heavy affairs and mostly run by steam. There were not enough of them to go around. More could not easily be made, for all the factories were working on munitions, and even if they had been made, they were too big and clumsy for the average field and, in addition, required the management of engineers. We had put together several tractors at our Manchester plant for demonstration purposes. They had been made in the United States and merely assembled in England. The Board of Agriculture requested the Royal Agricultural Society to make a test of these tractors and report. This is what they reported. At the request of the Royal Agricultural Society of England, we have examined two Ford tractors rated at 25 horsepower at work plowing. First, cross plowing a fallow of strong land in a dirty condition, and subsequently in a field of lighter land which had seeded itself down into rough grass, and which afforded every opportunity of testing the motor on the level and on a steep hill. In the first trial, a two-furrow Oliver plow was used, plowing on average 5 inches deep with a 16-inch wide furrow. A three-furrow cockshut plow was used at the same depth with the breast pitch 10 inches. In the second trial, the three-furrow plow was used, plowing an average of 6 inches deep. In both cases, the motor did its work with ease, and on a measured acre, the time occupied was 1 hour 30 minutes, with a consumption of 2 gallons of paraffin per acre. The results we consider very satisfactory. The plows were not quite suitable to the land, and the tractors, consequently, were working at some disadvantage. The total weight of the tractor, fully loaded with fuel and water, as weighed by us, was 23 1/4 centimweights. The tractor is light for its power, and, consequently, light on the land, is easily handled, turns in a small circle, and leaves a very narrow headland. The motor is quickly started up from cold on a small supply of petrol. After these trials, we proceeded to Messrs. Ford's works at Trafford Park, Manchester, where one of the motors had been sent to be dismantled and inspected in detail. We find the design of ample strength and the work of first-rate quality. We consider the driving wheels rather light, and we understand that a new and stronger pattern is to be supplied in future. The tractor is designed purely for working on the land, and the wheels, which are fitted with spuds, should be provided with some protection to enable them to travel on the road when moving from farm to farm. Bearing the above points in mind, we recommend, under existing circumstances, that steps be taken to construct immediately as many of these tractors as possible. The report was signed by Professor W. E. Dalby and F. S. Courtney, Engineering, R. N. Greaves, Engineering and Agriculture, Robert W. Hobbs and Henry Overman, Agriculture, Gilbert Greenall, Honorary Directors, and John E. Cross, Steward. Almost immediately after the filing of that report, we received the following wire: have not received anything definite concerning shipment necessary steel and plant for Cork factory. Under best circumstances, however, Cork factory production could not be available before next spring. The need for food production in England is imperative, and larger quantity of tractors must be available at earliest possible date for purpose breaking up existing grassland and plowing for fall wheat. Am requested by high authorities to appeal to Mr. Ford for help. Would you be willing to send Sorensen and others with drawings of everything necessary, loaning them to British government so that parts can be manufactured over here and assembled in government factories under Sorensen's guidance? Can you assure you positively this suggestion is made in national interest and, if carried out, will be done by the government for the people with no manufacturing or capitalist interest invested and no profit being made by any interests whatever? The matter is very urgent. Impossible to ship anything adequate from America because many thousand tractors must be provided. Ford tractor considered best and only suitable design. Consequently, national necessity entirely dependent Mr. Ford's design. My work prevents me coming America to present the proposal personally. Urge favorable consideration and immediate decision because every day is of vital importance. You may rely on manufacturing facility for production here under strictest impartial government control. Would welcome Sorensen and any and every other assistance and guidance you can furnish from America. Cable reply, Perry, care of Harding, Prodome, London. Prodome. I understand that its sending was directed by the British Cabinet. We at once cabled our entire willingness to lend the drawings, the benefit of what experience we had to date, and whatever men might be necessary to get production under way, and on the next ship sent Charles E. Sorensen with full drawings. Mr. Sorensen had opened the Manchester plant and was familiar with English conditions. He was in charge of the manufacture of tractors in this country. Mr. Sorensen started at work with the British officials to the end of having the parts made and assembled in England. Many of the materials which we used were special and could not be obtained in England. All of their factories equipped for doing casting and machine work were filled with munition orders. It proved to be exceedingly difficult for the ministry to get tenders of any kind. Then came June, and a series of destructive air raids on London. There was a crisis. Something had to be done. And finally, after passing to and fro among half the factories of England, our men succeeded in getting the tenders lodged with the ministry. Lord Milner exhibited these tenders to Mr. Sorensen. Taking the best of them, the price per tractor came to about $1,500 without any guarantee of delivery. "That price is all out of reason," said Mr. Sorensen. "These should not cost more than $700 apiece." "Can you make 5,000 at that price?" asked Lord Milner. "Yes," answered Mr. Sorensen. "How long will it take you to deliver them?" "We will start shipping within 60 days." They signed a contract on the spot, which, among other things, provided for an advance payment of 25% of the total sum. Mr. Sorensen cabled us what he had done and took the next boat home. The 25% payment was, by the way, not touched by us until the entire contract was completed. We deposited it in a kind of trust fund. The tractor works was not ready to go into production. The Highland Park plant might have been adapted, but every machine in it was going day and night on essential war work. There was only one thing to do. We ran up an emergency extension to put our plant at Dearborn, equipped it with machinery that was ordered by telegraph and mostly came by express. And in less than 60 days, the first tractors were on the docks in New York in the hands of the British authorities. They delayed in getting cargo space, but on December 6, 1917, we received this cable. London, December 5, 1917. Sorensen, Fordson, F.R. Dearborn. First tractors arrived. When will Smith and others leave? Cable. Perry. The entire shipment of 5,000 tractors went through within 3 months, and that is why the tractors were being used in England long before they were really known in the United States. The planning of the tractor really antedated that of the motor car. Out on the farm, my first experiments were with tractors, and it will be remembered that I was employed for some time by a manufacturer of steam tractors, the big heavy road and thresher engines. But I did not see any future for the large tractors. They were too expensive for the small farm, required too much skill to operate, and were much too heavy as compared with the pull they exerted. And anyway, the public was more interested in being carried than in being pulled. The horseless carriage made a greater appeal to the imagination. And so it was that I practically dropped work upon a tractor until the automobile was in production. With the automobile on the farms, the tractor became a necessity, for then the farmers had been introduced to power. The farmer does not stand so much in need of new tools as of power to run the tools that he has. I have followed many a weary mile behind a plow, and I know all the drudgery of it. What a waste it is for a human being to spend hours and days behind a slowly moving team of horses when, in the same time, a tractor could do 6 times as much work. It is no wonder that, doing everything slowly and by hand, the average farmer has not been able to earn more than a bare living, while farm products are never as plentiful and cheap as they ought to be. As in the automobile, we wanted power, not weight. The weight idea was firmly fixed in the minds of tractor makers. It was thought that excess weight meant excess pulling power, that the machine could not grip unless it were heavy. And this in spite of the fact that a cat has not much weight and is a pretty good climber. I have already set out my ideas on weight. The only kind of tractor that I thought worth working on was one that would be light, strong, and so simple that anyone could run it. Also, it had to be so cheap that anyone could buy it. With these ends in view, we worked for nearly 15 years on a design and spent some millions of dollars in experiments. We followed exactly the same course as with the automobile. Each part had to be as strong as it was possible to make it. The parts had to be few in number, and the whole had to admit of quantity production. We had some thought that perhaps the automobile engine might be used, and we conducted a few experiments with it. But finally, we became convinced that the kind of tractor we wanted and the automobile had practically nothing in common. It was the intention from the beginning that the tractor should be made as a separate undertaking from the automobile and in a distinct plant. No plant is big enough to make two articles. The automobile is designed to carry. The tractor is designed to pull, to climb. And that difference in function made all the difference in the world in construction. The hard problem was to get bearings that would stand up against the heavy pull. We finally got them, and a construction which seems to give the best average performance under all conditions. We fixed upon a 4-cylinder engine that is started by gasoline, but runs thereafter on kerosene. The lightest weight that we could attain with strength was 2,425 pounds. The grip is in the lugs on the driving wheels, as in the claws of the cat. In addition to its strictly pulling functions, the tractor, to be of the greatest service, had also to be designed for work as a stationary engine, so that when it was not out on the road or in the fields, it might be hitched up with a belt to run machinery. In short, it had to be a compact, versatile power plant, and that it has been. It has not only plowed, harrowed, cultivated, and reaped, but it has also threshed, run grist mills, sawmills, and various other sorts of mills, pulled stumps, plowed snow, and done about everything that a plant of moderate power could do, from sheep shearing to printing a newspaper. It has been fitted with heavy tires to haul on roads, with sledge runners for the woods and ice, and with rimmed wheels to run on rails. When the shops in Detroit were shut down by coal shortage, we got out the Dearborn Independent by sending a tractor to the electrotyping factory, stationing the tractor in the alley, sending up a belt four stories, and making the plates by tractor power. Its use in 95 lines of service has been called to our attention, and probably we know only a fraction of the uses. The mechanism of the tractor is even more simple than that of the automobile, and it is manufactured in exactly the same fashion. Until the present year, the production has been held back by the lack of a suitable factory. The first tractors had been made in the plant at Dearborn, which is now used as an experimental station. That was not large enough to affect the economies of large-scale production, and it could not well be enlarged, because the design was to make the tractors at the River Rouge plant, and that, until this year, was not in full operation. Now that plant is completed for the making of tractors. The work flows exactly as with the automobiles. Each part is a separate departmental undertaking, and each part as it is finished joins the conveyor system which leads it to its proper initial assembly and eventually into the final assembly. Everything moves, and there is no skilled work. The capacity of the present plant is 1 million tractors a year. That is the number we expect to make, for the world needs inexpensive, general utility power plants more now than ever before, and also it now knows enough about machinery to want such plants. The first tractors, as I have said, went to England. They were first offered in the United States in 1918 at $750. In the next year, with the higher costs, the price had to be made $885. In the middle of the year, it was possible again to make the introductory price of $750. In 1920, we charged $790. In the next year, we were sufficiently familiar with the production to begin cutting. The price came down to $625, and then in 1922, with the River Rouge plant functioning, we were able to cut to $395, all of which shows what getting into scientific production will do to a price. Just as I have no idea how cheaply the Ford automobile can eventually be made, I have no idea how cheaply the tractor can eventually be made. It is important that it shall be cheap, otherwise power will not go to all the farms, and they must all of them have power. Within a few years, a farm depending solely on horse and hand power will be as much of a curiosity as a factory run by a treadmill. The farmer must either take up power or go out of business. The cost figures make this inevitable. During the war, the government made a test of a Fordson tractor to see how its costs compared with doing the work with horses. The figures on the tractor were taken at the high price plus freight. The depreciation and repair items are not so great as the report sets them forth, and even if they were, the prices are cut in halves, which would therefore cut the depreciation and repair charge in halves. These are the figures. Cost, Fordson, $880. Wearing life, 4,800 hours at 4/5 acre per hour, 3,840 acres. 3,840 acres at $880. Depreciation per acre, 0.221. Repairs for 3,840 acres, $100. Per acre, 0.026. Fuel cost, kerosene at 19 cents, 2 gallons per acre, 38 cents. 1 gallon oil per 8 acres, per acre, 0.075. Driver, $2 per day, 8 acres, per acre, 0.25. Cost of plowing with Fordson per acre, 0.95. 8 horses cost $1,200. Working life, 5,000 hours at 4/5 acre per hour, 4,000 acres. 4,000 acres at $1,200. Depreciation of horses per acre, 30. Feed per horse, 40 cents. 100 working days per acre, 40. Feed per horse, 10 cents a day, 265 idle days per acre, 2.65. 2 drivers, 2 gang plows at $2 each per day per acre, 0.50. Cost of plowing with horses per acre, 1.46. At present costs, an acre would run about 40 cents, only 2 cents representing depreciation and repairs. But this does not take account of the time element. The plowing is done in about 1/4 the time, with only the physical energy used to steer the tractor. Plowing has become a matter of motoring across a field. Farming in the old style is rapidly fading into a picturesque memory. This does not mean that work is going to remove from the farm. Work cannot be removed from any life that is productive, but power farming does mean this. Drudgery is going to be removed from the farm. Power farming is simply taking the burden from flesh and blood and putting it on steel. We are in the opening years of power farming. The motor car wrought a revolution in modern farm life, not because it was a vehicle, but because it had power. Farming ought to be something more than a rural occupation. It ought to be the business of raising food. And when it does become a business, the actual work of farming the average sort of farm can be done in 24 days a year. The other days can be given over to other kinds of business. Farming is too seasonal an occupation to engage all of a man's time. As a food business, farming will justify itself as a business if it raises food in sufficient quantity and distributes it under such conditions as will enable every family to have enough food for its reasonable needs. There could not be a food trust if we were to raise such overwhelming quantities of all kinds of food as to make manipulation and exploitation impossible. The farmer who limits his planting plays into the hands of the speculators. And then, perhaps, we shall witness a revival of the small flour milling business. It was an evil day when the village flour mill disappeared. Cooperative farming will become so developed that we shall see associations of farmers with their own packing houses in which their own hogs will be turned into ham and bacon, and with their own flour mills in which their grain will be turned into commercial foodstuffs. Why a steer raised in Texas should be brought to Chicago and then served in Boston is a question that cannot be answered as long as all the steers the city needs could be raised near Boston. The centralization of food manufacturing industries, entailing enormous costs for transportation and organization, is too wasteful long to continue in a developed community. We shall have as great a development in farming during the next 20 years as we have had in manufacturing during the last 20. End of chapter 14. Chapter 15. Why charity? Why should there be any necessity for almsgiving in a civilized community? It is not the charitable mind to which I object. Heaven forbid that we should ever grow cold toward a fellow creature in need. Human sympathy is too fine for the cool, calculating attitude to take its place. One can name very few great advances that did not have human sympathy behind them. It is in order to help people that every notable service is undertaken. The trouble is that we have been using this great, fine motive force for ends too small. If human sympathy prompts us to feed the hungry, why should it not give the larger desire to make hunger in our midst impossible? If we have sympathy enough for people to help them out of their troubles, surely we ought to have sympathy enough to keep them out. It is easy to give. It is harder to make giving unnecessary. To make the giving unnecessary, we must look beyond the individual to the cause of his misery, not hesitating, of course, to relieve him in the meantime, but not stopping with mere temporary relief. The difficulty seems to be in getting to look beyond to the causes. More people can be moved to help a poor family than can be moved to give their minds toward the removal of poverty altogether. I have no patience with professional charity or with any sort of commercialized humanitarianism. The moment human helpfulness is systematized, organized, commercialized, and professionalized, the heart of it is extinguished, and it becomes a cold and clammy thing. Real human helpfulness is never card catalogued or advertised. There are more orphan children being cared for in the private homes of people who love them than in the institutions. There are more old people being sheltered by friends than you can find in the old people's homes. There is more aid by loans from family to family than by the loan societies. That is, human society on a humane basis looks out for itself. It is a grave question how far we ought to countenance the commercialization of the natural instinct of charity. Professional charity is not only cold, but it hurts more than it helps. It degrades the recipients and drugs their self-respect. Akin to it is sentimental idealism. The idea went abroad not so many years ago that service was something that we should expect to have done for us. Untold numbers of people became the recipients of well-meant social service. Whole sections of our population were coddled into a state of expectant, childlike helplessness. There grew up a regular profession of doing things for people, which gave an outlet for a laudable desire for service, but which contributed nothing whatever to the self-reliance of the people, nor to the correction of the conditions out of which the supposed need for such service grew. Worse than this encouragement of childish wistfulness, instead of training for self-reliance and self-sufficiency, was the creation of a feeling of resentment, which nearly always overtakes the objects of charity. People often complain of the ingratitude of those whom they help. Nothing is more natural. In the first place, precious little of our so-called charity is ever real charity, offered out of a heart full of interest and sympathy. In the second place, no person ever relishes being in a position where he is forced to take favors. Such social work creates a strained relation. The recipient of bounty feels that he has been belittled in the taking, and it is a question whether the giver should not also feel that he has been belittled in the giving. Charity never led to a settled state of affairs. The charitable system that does not aim to make itself unnecessary is not performing service. It is simply making a job for itself, and is an added item to the record of non-production. Charity becomes unnecessary as those who seem to be unable to earn livings are taken out of the non-productive class and put into the productive. In a previous chapter, I have set out how experiments in our shops have demonstrated that in sufficiently subdivided industry, there are places which can be filled by the maimed, the halt, and the blind. Scientific industry need not be a monster devouring all who come near it. When it is, then it is not fulfilling its place in life. In and out of industry, there must be jobs that take the full strength of a powerful man. There are other jobs, and plenty of them, that require more skill than the artisans of the Middle Ages ever had. The minute subdivision of industry permits a strong man or a skilled man always to use his strength or skill. In the old hand industry, a skilled man spent a good part of his time at unskilled work. That was a waste. But since in those days every task required both skilled and unskilled labor to be performed by the one man, there was little room for either the man who was too stupid ever to be skilled, or the man who did not have the opportunity to learn a trade. No mechanic working with only his hands can earn more than a bare sustenance. He cannot have a surplus. It has been taken for granted that, coming into old age, a mechanic must be supported by his children, or, if he has no children, that he will be a public charge. All of that is quite unnecessary. The subdivision of industry opens places that can be filled by practically anyone. There are more places in subdivision industry than can be filled by blind men than there are blind men. There are more places that can be filled by cripples than there are cripples. And in each of these places, the man who short-sightedly might be considered as an object of charity can earn just as adequate a living as the keenest and most able-bodied. It is waste to put an able-bodied man in a job that might be just as well cared for by a cripple. It is a frightful waste to put the blind at weaving baskets. It is a waste to have convicts breaking stone or picking hemp or doing any sort of petty, useless task. A well-conducted jail should not only be self-supporting, but a man in jail ought to be able to support his family or, if he has no family, he should be able to accumulate a sum of money sufficient to put him on his feet when he gets out of jail. I am not advocating convict labor or the farming out of men practically as slaves. Such a plan is too detestable for words. We have greatly overdone the prison business anyway. We begin at the wrong end. But as long as we have prisons, they can be fitted into the general scheme of production so neatly that a prison may become a productive unit working for the relief of the public and the benefit of the prisoners. I know that there are laws, foolish laws passed by unthinking men, that restrict the industrial activities of prisons. Those laws were passed mostly at the behest of what is called labor. They are not for the benefit of the working man. Increasing the charges upon a community does not benefit anyone in the community. If the idea of service be kept in mind, then there is always, in every community, more work to do than there are men who can do it. Industry organized for service removes the need for philanthropy. Philanthropy, no matter how noble its motive, does not make for self-reliance. We must have self-reliance. A community is the better for being discontented, for being dissatisfied for what it has. I do not mean the petty, daily, nagging, gnawing sort of discontent, but a broad, courageous sort of discontent which believes that everything which is done can and ought to be eventually done better. Industry organized for service, and the working man, as well as the leader, must serve, can pay wages sufficiently large to permit every family to be both self-reliant and self-supporting. A philanthropy that spends its time and money in helping the world to do more for itself is far better than the sort which merely gives and thus encourages idleness. Philanthropy, like everything else, ought to be productive, and I believe that it can be. I have personally been experimenting with a trade school and a hospital to discover if such institutions, which are commonly regarded as benevolent, cannot be made to stand on their own feet. I have found that they can be. I am not in sympathy with the trade school as it is commonly organized. The boys get only a smattering of knowledge, and they do not learn how to use that knowledge. The trade school should not be a cross between a technical college and a school. It should be a means of teaching boys to be productive. If they are put at useless tasks, making articles and then throwing them away, they cannot have the interest or acquire the knowledge which is their right. And during the period of schooling, the boy is not productive. The schools, unless by charity, make no provision for the support of the boy. Many boys need support. They must work at the first thing which comes to hand. They have no chance to pick and choose. When the boy thus enters life untrained, he but adds to the already great scarcity of competent labor. Modern industry requires a degree of ability and skill which neither early quitting of school nor long continuance at school provides. It is true that, in order to retain the interest of the boy and train him in handicraft, manual training departments have been introduced in the more progressive school systems, but even these are confessedly makeshifts because they only cater to, without satisfying, the normal boy's creative instincts. To meet this condition, to fulfill the boy's educational possibilities and at the same time begin his industrial training along constructive lines, the Henry Ford Trade School was incorporated in 1916. We do not use the word philanthropy in connection with this effort. It grew out of a desire to aid the boy whose circumstances compelled him to leave school early. This desire to aid fitted in conveniently with the necessity of providing trained toolmakers in the shops. From the beginning, we have held to three cardinal principles. First, that the boy was to be kept a boy and not changed into a premature working man. Second, that the academic training was to go hand in hand with the industrial instruction. Third, that the boy was to be given a sense of pride and responsibility in his work by being trained on articles which were to be used. He works on objects of recognized industrial work. The school is incorporated as a private school and is open to boys between the ages of 12 and 18. It is organized on the basis of scholarships, and each boy is awarded an annual cash scholarship of $400 at his entrance. This is gradually increased to a maximum of $600 if his record is satisfactory. A record of the class and shop work is kept and also of the industry the boy displays in each. It is the marks in industry which are used in making subsequent adjustments of his scholarship. In addition to his scholarship, Each boy is given a small amount each month which must be deposited in his savings account. This thrift fund must be left in the bank as long as the boy remains in the school, unless he is given permission by the authorities to use it for an emergency. One by one, the problems of managing the school are being solved, and better ways of accomplishing its objects are being discovered. At the beginning, it was the custom to give the boy one-third of the day in classwork and two-thirds in shop work. This daily adjustment was found to be a hindrance to progress, and now the boy takes his training in blocks of weeks, 1 week in the class and 2 weeks in the shop. Classes are continuous, the various groups taking their weeks in turn. The best instructors obtainable are on the staff, and the textbook is the Ford plant. It offers more resources for practical education than most universities. The arithmetic lessons come in concrete shop problems. No longer is the boy's mind tortured with the mysterious A, who can row 4 miles while B is rowing 2. The actual process and actual conditions are exhibited to him. He is taught to observe. Cities are no longer black specks on maps, and continents are not just pages of a book. The shop shipments to Singapore, the shop receipts of material from Africa and South America are shown to him, and the world becomes an inhabited planet instead of a colored globe on the teacher's desk. In physics and chemistry, the industrial plant provides a laboratory in which theory becomes practice and the lesson becomes actual experience. Suppose the action of a pump is being taught. The teacher explains the parts and their functions, answers questions, and then they all troop away to the engine rooms to see a great pump. The school has a regular factory workshop with the finest equipment. The boys work up from one machine to the next. They work solely on parts or articles needed by the company, but our needs are so vast that this list comprehends nearly everything. The inspected work is purchased by the Ford Motor Company, and, of course, the work that does not pass inspection is a loss to the school. The boys who have progressed furthest do fine micrometer work, and they do every operation with a clear understanding of the purposes and principles involved. They repair their own machines. They learn how to take care of themselves around machinery. They study pattern making, and in clean, well-lighted rooms, with their instructors, they lay the foundation for successful careers. When they graduate, places are always open for them in the shops at good wages. The social and moral well-being of the boys is given an unobtrusive care. The supervision is not of authority, but of friendly interest. The home conditions of every boy are pretty well known, and his tendencies are observed, and no attempt is made to coddle him. No attempt is made to render him namby-pamby. One day, when two boys came to the point of a fight, they were not lectured on the wickedness of fighting. They were counseled to make up their differences in a better way, but when, boy-like, they preferred the more primitive mode of settlement, they were given gloves and made to fight it out in a corner of the shop. The only prohibition laid upon them was that they were to finish it there and not to be caught fighting outside the shop. The result was a short encounter and friendship. They are handled as boys, their better boyish instincts are encouraged, and when one sees them in the shops and classes, one cannot easily miss the light of dawning mastery in their eyes. They have a sense of belonging. They feel they are doing something worthwhile. They learn readily and eagerly because they are learning the things which every active boy wants to learn and about which he is constantly asking questions that none of his home folks can answer. Beginning with 6 boys, the school now has 200 and is possessed of so practical a system that it may expand to 700. It began with a deficit, but as it is, one of my basic ideas that anything worthwhile in itself can be made self-sustaining. It has so developed its processes that it is now paying its way. We have been able to let the boy have his boyhood. These boys learn to be workmen, but they do not forget how to be boys. That is of the first importance. They earn from 19 to 35 cents an hour, which is more than they could earn as boys in the sort of job open to a youngster. They can better help support their families by staying in school than by going out to work. When they are through, they have a good general education, the beginning of a technical education, and they are so skilled as workmen that they can earn wages which will give them the liberty to continue their education if they like. If they do not want more education, they have at least the skill to command high wages anywhere. They do not have to go into our factories. Most of them do, because they do not know where better jobs are to be had. We want all our jobs to be good for the men who take them. But there is no string tied to the boys. They have earned their own way and are under obligations to no one. There is no charity. The place pays for itself. The Ford Hospital is being worked out on somewhat similar lines, but because of the interruption of the war, when it was given to the government and became General Hospital No. 36, housing some 1,500 patients, the work has not yet advanced to the point of absolutely definite results. I did not deliberately set out to build this hospital. It began in 1914 as the Detroit General Hospital and was designed to be erected by popular subscription. With others, I made a subscription, and the building began. Long before the first buildings were done, the funds became exhausted, and I was asked to make another subscription. I refused, because I thought that the managers should have known how much the building was going to cost before they started. And that sort of a beginning did not give great confidence as to how the place would be managed after it was finished. However, I did offer to take the whole hospital, paying back all the subscriptions that had been made. This was accomplished, and we were going forward with the work when, on August 1, 1918, the whole institution was turned over to the government. It was returned to us in October 1919, and on the 10th day of November of the same year, the first private patient was admitted. The hospital is on West Grand Boulevard in Detroit, and the plot embraces 20 acres, so that there will be ample room for expansion. It is our thought to extend the facilities as they justify themselves. The original design of the hospital has been quite abandoned, and we have endeavored to work out a new kind of hospital, both in design and management. There are plenty of hospitals for the rich. There are plenty of hospitals for the poor. There are no hospitals for those who can afford to pay only a moderate amount and yet desire to pay without a feeling that they are recipients of charity. It has been taken for granted that a hospital cannot both serve and be self-supporting, that it has to be either an institution kept going by private contributions or pass into the class of private sanitariums managed for profit. This hospital is designed to be self-supporting, to give maximum of service at a minimum of cost and without the slightest coloring of charity. In the new buildings that we have erected, there are no wards. All of the rooms are private, and each one is provided with a bath. The rooms, which are in groups of 24, are all identical in size, in fittings, and in furnishings. There is no choice of rooms. it is planned that there shall be no choice of anything within the hospital. Every patient is on an equal footing with every other patient. It is not at all certain whether hospitals as they are now managed exist for patients or for doctors. I am not unmindful of the large amount of time which a capable physician or surgeon gives to charity, but also I am not convinced that the fees of surgeons should be regulated according to the wealth of the patient, and I am entirely convinced that what is known as professional etiquette is a curse to mankind and to the development of medicine. Diagnosis is not very much developed. I should not care to be among the proprietors of a hospital in which every step had not been taken to ensure that the patients were being treated for what actually was the matter with them, instead of for something that one doctor had decided they had. Professional etiquette makes it very difficult for a wrong diagnosis to be corrected. The consulting physician, unless he be a man of great tact, will not change a diagnosis or a treatment unless the physician who has called him in is in thorough agreement. And then, if a change be made, it is usually without the knowledge of the patient. There seems to be a notion that a patient, and especially when in a hospital, becomes the property of the doctor. A conscientious practitioner does not exploit the patient. A less conscientious one does. Many physicians seem to regard the sustaining of their own diagnoses as of as great moment as the recovery of the patient. It has been an aim of our hospital to cut away from all of these practices and to put the interest of the patient first. Therefore, it is what is known as a closed hospital. All of the physicians and all of the nurses are employed by the year, and they can have no practice outside of the hospital. Including the interns, 21 physicians and surgeons are on the staff. These men have been selected with great care, and they are paid salaries that amount to at least as much as they would ordinarily earn in successful private practice. They have, none of them, any financial interest whatsoever in any patient, and a patient may not be treated by a doctor from the outside. We gladly acknowledge the place and the use of the family physician. We do not seek to supplant him. We take the case where he leaves off and return the patient as quickly as possible. Our system makes it undesirable for us to keep patients longer than necessary. We do not need that kind of business. And we will share with the family physician our knowledge of the case, but while the patient is in the hospital, we will assume full responsibility. It is closed to outside physicians' practice, though it is not closed to our cooperation with any family physician who desires it. The admission of a patient is interesting. The incoming patient is first examined by the senior physician and then is routed for examination through 3, 4, or whatever number of doctors seems necessary. This routing takes place regardless of what the patient came to the hospital for, because, as we are gradually learning, it is the complete health rather than a single ailment which is important. Each of the doctors makes a complete examination, and each sends in his written findings to the head physician without any opportunity whatsoever to consult with any of the other examining physicians. At least 3, and sometimes 6 or 7, absolutely complete and absolutely diagnoses are thus in the hands of the head of the hospital. They constitute a complete record of the case. These precautions are taken in order to ensure, within the limits of present-day knowledge, a correct diagnosis. At the present time, there are about 600 beds available. Every patient pays according to a fixed schedule, That includes the hospital room, board, medical and surgical attendants, and nursing. There are no extras. There are no private nurses. If a case requires more attention than the nurses assigned to the wing can give, then another nurse is put on, but without any additional expense to the patient. This, however, is rarely necessary because the patients are grouped according to the amount of nursing that they will need. There may be one nurse for two patients or one nurse for five patients, as the type of cases may require. No one nurse ever has more than seven patients to care for, and because of the arrangements, it is entirely possible for a nurse to care for seven patients who are not desperately ill. In the ordinary hospital, the nurses must take many useless steps. More of their time is spent in walking than in caring for the patient. This hospital is designed to save steps. Each floor is complete in itself, and just as in the factories, we have tried to eliminate the necessity for waste motion, so have we also tried to eliminate waste motion in the hospital. The charge to patients for a room, nursing, and medical attendance is $4.50 a day. This will be lowered as the size of the hospital increases. The charge for a major operation is $125. The charge for minor operations is according to a fixed scale. All of the charges are tentative. The hospital has a cost system just like a factory. The charges will be regulated to make ends just meet. There seems to be no good reason why the experiment should not be successful. Its success is purely a matter of management and mathematics. The same kind of management which permits a factory to give the fullest service will permit a hospital to give the fullest service, and at prices so low as to be within the reach of everyone. The only difference between hospital and factory accounting is that I do not expect the hospital to return a profit. We do not expect it to cover depreciation. The investment in this hospital to date is about $9 million. If we can get away from charity, the funds that now go into charitable enterprises can be turned to furthering production, to making goods cheaply and in great plenty. And then we shall not only be removing the burden of taxes from the community and freeing men, but also we can be adding to the general wealth. We leave for private interest too many things we ought to do for ourselves as a collective interest. We need more constructive thinking in public service. We need a kind of universal training in economic facts. The overreaching ambitions of speculative capital, as well as the unreasonable demands of irresponsible labor, are due to ignorance in the economic basis of life. Nobody can get more out of life than life can produce. Yet nearly everybody thinks he can. Speculative capital wants more, labor wants more, the source of raw material wants more, and the purchasing public wants more. A family knows that it cannot live beyond its income. Even the children know that. But the public never seems to learn that it cannot live beyond its income, have more than it produces. In clearing out the need for charity, we must keep in mind not only the economic facts of existence, but also the lack of knowledge of these facts encourages fear. Banish fear, and we can have self-reliance. Charity is not present where self-reliance dwells. Fear is the offspring of a reliance placed on something outside, on a foreman's goodwill, perhaps, on a shop's prosperity, on a market's steadiness. That is just another way of saying that fear is the portion of the man who acknowledges his career to be in the keeping of earthly circumstances. Fear is the result of the body assuming ascendancy over the soul. The habit of failure is purely mental and is the mother of fear. This habit gets itself fixed on men because they lack vision. They start out to do something that reaches from A to Z. At A they fail, at B they stumble, and at C they meet with what seems to be an insuperable difficulty. Then they cry beaten and throw the whole task down. They have not even given themselves a chance really to fail. They have not given their vision a chance to be proved or disproved. They have simply let themselves be beaten by the natural difficulties that attend every kind of effort. More men are beaten than fail. It is not wisdom they need, or money, or brilliance, or pull, but just plain gristle and bone. This rude, simple, primitive power, which we call stick-to-itiveness, is the uncrowned king of the world of endeavor. People are utterly wrong in their slant upon things. They see the success that men have made, and somehow they appear to be easy. But that is a world away from the facts. It is failure that is easy. Success is always hard. A man can fail in ease. He can succeed only by paying out all that he has and is. It is this which makes success so pitiable a thing if it be in lines that are not useful and uplifting. If a man is in constant fear of the industrial situation, he ought to change his life so as not to be dependent upon it. There is always the land, and fewer people are on the land now than ever before. If a man lives in fear of an employer's favor changing toward him, he ought to extricate himself from dependence on any employer. He can become his own boss. It may be that he will be a poorer boss than the one he leaves, and that his return will be much less, but at least he will have rid himself of the shadow of his pet fear, and that is worth a great deal in money and position. Better still is for the man to come through himself and exceed himself by getting rid of his fears in the midst of the circumstances where his daily lot is cast. Become a free man in the place where you first surrendered your freedom. Win your battle where you lost it. And you will come to see that, although there was much outside of you that was not right, there was more inside of you that was not right. Thus you will learn that the wrong inside of you spoils even the right that is outside of you. A man is still the superior being of the earth. Whatever happens, he is still a man. Business may slacken tomorrow, he is still a man. He goes through the changes of circumstances, as he goes through the variations of temperature, still a man. If he can only get his thought reborn in him, it opens new wells and mines his own being. There is no security outside of himself. There is no wealth outside of himself. The elimination of fear is the bringing in of security and supply. Let every American become steeled against coddling. Americans ought to resent coddling. It is a drug. Stand up and stand out. Let weaklings take charity. End of chapter 15.
Chapter 16. The Railroads. Nothing in this country furnishes a better example of how a business may be turned from its function of service than do the railroads. We have a railroad problem, and much learned thought and discussion have been devoted to the solution of that problem. Everyone is dissatisfied with the railroads. The public is dissatisfied because both the passenger and freight rates are too high. The railroad employees are dissatisfied because they say their wages are too low and their hours too long. The owners of the railways are dissatisfied because it is claimed that no adequate return is realized upon the money invested. All of the contacts of a properly managed undertaking ought to be satisfactory. if the public, the employees, and the owners do not find themselves better off because of the undertaking, then there must be something very wrong indeed with the manner in which the undertaking is carried through. I am entirely without any disposition to pose as a railroad authority. There may be railroad authorities, but if the service as rendered by the American Railroad today is the result of accumulated railway knowledge, then I cannot say that my respect for the usefulness of that knowledge is at all profound. I have not the slightest doubt in the world that the active managers of the railways, the men who really do the work, are entirely capable of conducting the railways of the country to the satisfaction of everyone, and I have equally no doubt that these active managers have, by force of a chain of circumstances, all but ceased to manage. And right there is the source of most of the trouble. The men who know railroading have not been allowed to manage railroads. In a previous chapter on finance were set forth the dangers attendant upon the indiscriminate borrowing of money. It is inevitable that anyone who can borrow freely to cover errors of management will borrow rather than correct the errors. Our railway managers have been practically forced to borrow, for since the very inception of the railways, they have not been free agents. The guiding hand of the railway has been, not the railroad man, but the banker. When railroad credit was high, more money was to be made out of floating bond issues and speculating in the securities than out of service to the public. A very small fraction of the money earned by the railways has gone back into the rehabilitation of the properties. When, by skilled management, the net revenue became large enough to pay a considerable dividend upon the stock, then that dividend was used first by the speculators on the inside and controlling the railroad fiscal policy to boom the stock and unload their holdings, and then to float a bond issue on the strength of the credit gained through the earnings. When the earnings dropped, or were artificially depressed, then the speculators bought back the stock, and in the course of time, staged another advance and unloading. There is scarcely a railroad in the United States that has not been through one or more receiverships, due to the fact that the financial interests piled on load after load of securities until the structures grew top-heavy and fell over. Then they got in on the receiverships, made money at the expense of gullible security holders, and started the same old pyramiding game all over again. The natural ally of the banker is the lawyer. Such games as have been played on the railroads have needed expert legal advice. Lawyers, like bankers, know absolutely nothing about business. They imagine that a business is properly conducted if it keeps within the law or if the law can be altered or interpreted to suit the purpose in hand. They live on rules. The bankers took finance out of the hands of the managers. They put in lawyers to see that the railroads violated the law only in legal fashion and thus grew up immense legal departments. Instead of operating under the rules of common sense and according to circumstances, every railroad had to operate on the advice of counsel. Rules spread through every part of the organization. Then came the avalanche of state and federal regulations, until today we find the railways hogtied in a mass of rules and regulations. When the lawyers and the financiers on the inside and various state commissions on the outside, the railway manager has little chance. That is a trouble with the railways. Business cannot be conducted by law. We have had the opportunity of demonstrating to ourselves what a freedom from the banker legal mortmain means in our experience with the Detroit, Toledo, and Ironton Railway. We bought the railway
because its right-of-way interfered with some of our improvements on the River Rouge. We did not buy it as an investment, or as an adjunct to our industries, or because of its strategic position. The extraordinarily good situation of the railway seems to have become universally apparent only since we bought it. That, however, is beside the point. We bought the railway because it interfered with our plans. Then we had to do something with it. The only thing to do was to run it as a productive enterprise, applying to it exactly the same principles as are applied in every department for our industries. We have as yet made no special efforts of any kind, and the railway has not been set up as a demonstration of how every railway should be run. It is true that applying the rule of maximum service at minimum cost has caused the income of the road to exceed the outgo, which, for that road, represents a most unusual condition. It has been represented that the changes we have made, and remember they have been made simply as part of the day's work, are peculiarly revolutionary and quite without application to railway management in general. Personally, it would seem to me that our little line does not differ much from the big lines. In our own work, we have always found that, if our principles were right, the area over which they were applied did not matter. The principles that we use in the big Highland Park plant seem to work equally well in every plant that we establish. It has never made any difference with us whether we multiplied what we were doing by 5 or 500. Size is only a matter of the multiplication table, anyway. The Detroit, Toledo, and Ironton Railway was organized some 20-odd years ago, and has been reorganized every few years since then. The last reorganization was in 1914. The war and the federal control of the railways interrupted the cycle of reorganization. The road owns 343 miles of track, has 52 miles of branches, and 45 miles of trackage rights over the roads. It goes from Detroit, almost due south to Ironton on the Ohio River, thus tapping the West Virginia coal deposits. It crosses most of the large trunk lines, and it is a road which, from a general business standpoint, ought to pay. It has paid. It seems to have paid the bankers. In 1913, the net capitalization per mile of road was $105,000. In the next receivership, this was cut down to $47,000 per mile. I do not know how much money in all has been raised on the strength of the road. I do know that in the reorganization of 1914, the bondholders were assessed and forced to turn into the treasury nearly $5 million, which is the amount that we paid for the entire road. We paid 60 cents on the dollar for the outstanding mortgage bonds, although the ruling price just before the time of purchase was between 30 and 40 cents on the dollar. We paid a dollar a share for the common stock and $5 a share for the preferred stock, which seemed to be a fair price, considering that no interest had ever been paid upon the bonds, and a dividend on the stock was a most remote possibility. The rolling stock of the road consisted of about 70 locomotives, 27 passenger cars, and around 2,800 freight cars. All of the rolling stock was in extremely bad condition, and a good part of it would not run at all. All of the buildings were dirty, unpainted, and generally run down. The roadbed was something more than a streak of rust and something less than a railway. The repair shops were overmanned and under-machined. Practically everything connected with operation was conducted with a maximum of waste. There was, however, an exceedingly ample executive and administration department, and of course a legal department. The legal department alone cost in 1 month nearly $18,000. We took over the road in March 1921. We began to apply industrial principles. There had been an executive office in Detroit. We closed that up and put the administration into the charge of one man and gave him half of the flat-top desk out in the freight office. The legal department went with the executive offices. There is no reason for so much litigation in connection with railroading. Our people quickly settled all the mass of outstanding claims, some of which had been hanging on for years. As new claims arise, they are settled at once and on the facts, so that the legal expense seldom exceeds $200 a month. All of the unnecessary accounting and red tape were thrown out, and the payroll of the road was reduced from 2,700 to 1,650 men. Following our general policy, all titles and offices, other than those required by law, were abolished. The ordinary railway organization is rigid. A message has to go up through a certain line of authority, and no man is expected to do anything without explicit orders from his superior. One morning, I went out to the road very early and found a wrecking train with steam up, a crew aboard, and all ready to start. It had been awaiting orders for half an hour. We went down and cleared the wreck before the orders came through. That was before the idea of personal responsibility had soaked in. It was a little hard to break the orders habit. The men at first were afraid to take responsibility, but as we went on, they seemed to like the plan more and more, and now no man limits his duties. A man is paid for a day's work of 8 hours, and he is expected to work during those 8 hours. If he is an engineer and finishes a run in 4 hours, then he works at whatever else may be in demand for the next 4 hours. If a man works more than 8 hours, he is not paid for overtime. He deducts his overtime from the next working day or saves it up and gets a whole day off with pay. Our 8-hour day is a day of 8 hours and not a basis for computing pay. The minimum wage is $6 a day. There are no extra men. We have cut down in the offices, in the shops, and on the roads. In one shop, 20 men are now doing more work than 59 did before. Not long ago, one of our track gangs, consisting of a foreman and 15 men, was working beside a parallel road on which was a gang of 40 men doing exactly the same sort of track repairing and ballasting. In 5 days, our gang did 2 telegraph poles more than the competing gang. The road is being rehabilitated. Nearly the whole track has been re-ballasted, and many miles of new rails have been laid. The locomotives and rolling stock are being overhauled in our own shops and at a very slight expense. We found that the supplies bought previously were of poor quality or unfitted for the use. We are saving money on supplies by buying better qualities and seeing that nothing is wasted. The men seem entirely willing to cooperate in saving. They do not discard that which might be used. We ask a man, "What can you get out of an engine?" And he answers with an economy record. And we are not pouring in great amounts of money. Everything is being done out of earnings. That is our policy. The trains must go through and on time. The time of freight movements has been cut down about 2/3. A car on a siding is not just a car on a siding. It is a great big question mark. Someone has to know why it is there. It used to take 8 or 9 days to get freight through to Philadelphia or New York. Now it takes 3.5 days. The organization is serving. All sorts of explanations are put forward of why a deficit was turned into a surplus. I am told that it is all due to diverting the freight of the Ford industries. If we had diverted all of our business to this road, that would not explain why we manage at so much lower an operating cost than before. We are routing as much as we can of our own business over the road, but only because we there get the best service. For years past, we had been trying to send freight over this road because it was conveniently located, but we had never been able to use it to any extent because of the delayed deliveries. We could not count on a shipment to within 5 or 6 weeks. That tied up too much money and also broke into our production schedule. There was no reason why the road should not have had a schedule, but it did not. The delays became legal matters to be taken up in due legal course. That is not the way of business. We think that a delay is a criticism of our work and is something at once to be investigated. That is business. The railroads in general have broken down, and if the former conduct of the Detroit, Toledo, and Ironton is any criterion of management in general, there is no reason in the world why they should not have broken down. Too many railroads are run, not from the offices of practical men, but from banking offices and the principles of procedure. The whole outlook are financial, not transportational, but financial. There has been a breakdown simply because more attention has been paid to railroads as factors in the stock market than as servants of the people. Outworn ideas have been retained, development has been practically stopped, and railroad men with vision have not been set free to grow. Will $1 billion solve that sort of trouble? No, $1 billion will only make the difficulty $1 billion worse. The purpose of the billion is simply to continue the present methods of railroad management, and it is because of the present methods that we have any railroad difficulties at all. The mistaken and foolish things we did years ago are just overtaking us. At the beginning of railway transportation in the United States, the people had to be taught its use, just as they had to be taught the use of the telephone. Also, the new railroads had to make business in order to keep themselves solvent. And because railway financing began in one of the rottenest periods of our business history, a number of practices were established as precedents, which have influenced railway work ever since. One of the first things the railways did was to throttle all other methods of transportation. There was the beginning of a splendid canal system in this country, and a great movement for canalization was at its height. The railroad companies bought out the canal companies and let the canals fill up and choke with weeds and refuse. All over the eastern and in parts of the middle western states are the remains of this network of internal waterways. They are being restored now as rapidly as possible. They are being linked together. Various commissions, public and private, have seen the vision of a complete system of waterways serving all parts of the country. And thanks to their efforts, persistence, and faith, progress is being made. But there was another. This was the system of making the haul as long as possible. Anyone who is familiar with the exposures which resulted in the formation of the Interstate Commerce Commission knows what is meant by this. There was a period when rail transport was not regarded as the servant of the traveling, manufacturing, and commercial publics. Business was treated as if it existed for the benefit of the railways. During this period of folly, it was not good railroading to get goods from their shipping point to their destination by the most direct line possible, but to keep them on the road as long as possible, send them around the longest way, give as many connecting lines as possible a piece of the profit, and let the public stand the resulting loss of time and money. That was once counted good railroading. It has not entirely passed out of practice today. One of the great changes in our economic life to which this railroad policy contributed was the centralization of certain activities, not because centralization was necessary, nor because it contributed to the well-being of the people, but because, among other things, it made double business for the railroads. Take two staples, meat and grain. If you look at the maps, which the packing houses put out, and see where the cattle are drawn from, and then if you consider that the cattle, when converted into food, are hauled again by the same railways back to the place where they came from, you will get some sidelight on the transportation problem and the price of meat. Take also grain. Every reader of advertisements knows where the great flour mills of the country are located, and they probably know also that these great mills are not located in the sections where the grain of the United States is raised. There are staggering quantities of grain, thousands of trainloads, hauled uselessly long distances, and then in the form of flour, hauled back again long distances to the states and sections where the grain was raised, a burdening of the railroads, which is of no benefit to the communities where the grain originated, nor to anyone else except the monopolistic mills and the railroads. The railroads can always do a big business without helping the business of the country at all. They can always be engaged in just such useless hauling. On meat and grain, and perhaps on cotton too, the transportation burden could be reduced by more than half by the preparation of the product for use before it is shipped. If a coal community mined coal in Pennsylvania and then sent it by railway to Michigan or Wisconsin to be screened, and then hauled it back again to Pennsylvania for use, it would not be much sillier than the hauling of Texas beef alive to Chicago, there to be killed, and then shipped back dead to Texas, or the hauling of Kansas grain to Minnesota, there to be ground in the mills and hauled back again as flour. It is good business for the railroads, but it is bad business for business. One angle of the transportation problem to which too few men are paying attention is this useless hauling of material. If the problem were tackled from the point of ridding the railroads of their useless hauls, we might discover that we are in better shape than we think to take care of the legitimate transportation business of the country. In commodities like coal, it is necessary that they be hauled from where they are to where they are needed. The same is true of the raw materials of industry. They must be hauled from the place where nature has stored them to the place where there are people ready to work them. And as these raw materials are not often found assembled in one section, a considerable amount of transportation to a central assembling place is necessary. The coal comes from one section, the copper from another, the iron from another, the wood from another. They all must be brought together. But wherever it is possible, a policy of decentralization ought to be adopted. We need, instead of mammoth flour mills, a multitude of smaller mills distributed through all the sections where grain is grown. Wherever it is possible, the section that produces the raw material ought to produce also the finished product. Grain should be ground to flour where it is grown. A hog-growing country should not export hogs, but pork, hams, and bacon. The cotton mills ought to be near the cotton fields. This is not a revolutionary idea. In a sense, it is a reactionary one. It does not suggest anything new. It suggests something that is very old. This is the way the country did things before we fell into the habit of carting everything around a few thousand miles and adding the cartage to the consumer's bill. Our communities ought to be more complete in themselves. They ought not to be unnecessarily dependent on railway transportation. Out of what they produce, they should supply their own needs and ship the surplus. And how can they do this unless they have the means of taking their raw materials, like grain and cattle, and changing them into finished products? If private enterprise does not yield these means, the cooperation of farmers can. The chief injustice sustained by the farmer today is that, being the greatest producer, he is prevented from being also the greatest merchandiser, because he is compelled to sell to those who put his products into merchantable form. If he could change his grain into flour, his cattle into beef, and his hogs into hams and bacon, not only would he receive the fuller profit of his product, but he would render his nearby communities more independent of railway exigencies and thereby improve the transportation system by relieving it of the burden of his unfinished product. The thing is not only reasonable and practicable, but it is becoming absolutely necessary. More than that, it is being done in many places. But it will not register its full effect on the transportation situation and upon the cost of living until it is done more widely and in more kinds of materials. It is one of nature's compensations to withdraw prosperity from the business which does not serve. We have found that on the Detroit, Toledo, and Ironton we could, following our universal policy, reduce our rates and get more business. We made some cuts, but the Interstate Commerce Commission refused to allow them. Under such conditions, why discuss the railroads as a business or as a service? End of chapter 16.
Chapter 17. Things in General. No man exceeds Thomas A. Edison in broad vision and understanding. I met him first, many years ago, when I was with the Detroit Edison Company, probably about 1887 or thereabouts. The electrical men held a convention at Atlantic City, and Edison, as the leader in electrical science, made an address. I was then working on my gasoline engine, and most people, including all my associates in the electrical company, had taken pains to tell me that time spent on a gasoline engine was time wasted, that the power of the future was to be electricity. These criticisms had not made any impression on me. I was working ahead with all my might, but being in the same room with Edison suggested to me that it would be a good idea to find out if the master of electricity thought it was going to be the only power in the future. So, after Mr. Edison had finished his address, I managed to catch him alone for a moment. I told him what I was working on. At once he was interested. He is interested in every search for new knowledge. And then I asked him if he thought that there was a future for the internal combustion engine. He answered something in this fashion. Yes, there is a big future for any lightweight engine that can develop a high horsepower and be self-contained. No one kind of motive power is ever going to do all the work of the country. We do not know what electricity can do, but I take for granted that it cannot do everything. Keep on with your engine. If you can get what you are after, I can see a great future. That is characteristic of Edison. He was the central figure in the electrical industry, which was then young and enthusiastic. The rank and file of the electrical men could see nothing ahead but electricity,
but their leader could see with crystal clearness that no one power could do all the work of the country. I suppose that is why he was the leader. Such was my first meeting with Edison. I did not see him again until many years after, until our motor had been developed and was in production. He remembered perfectly our first meeting. Since then, we have seen each other often. He is one of my closest friends, and we together have swapped many an idea. His knowledge is almost universal. He is interested in every conceivable subject, and he recognizes no limitations. He believes that all things are possible. At the same time, he keeps his feet on the ground. He goes forward step by step. He regards impossible as a description for that which we have not at the moment the knowledge to achieve. He knows that as we amass knowledge, we build the power to overcome the impossible. That is the rational way of doing the impossible. The irrational way is to make the attempt without the toil of accumulating knowledge. Mr. Edison is only approaching the height of his power. He is the man who is going to show us what chemistry really can do, for he is a real scientist who regards the knowledge for which he is always searching as a tool to shape the progress of the world. He is not the type of scientist who merely stores up knowledge and turns his head into a museum. Edison is easily the world's greatest scientist. I am not sure that he is not also the world's worst businessman. He knows almost nothing of business. John Burroughs was another of those who honored me with their friendship. I, too, like birds. I like the outdoors. I like to walk across the country and jump fences. We have 500 bird houses on the farm. We call them our bird hotels, and one of them, the Hotel Pontchartrain, a Martin house, has 76 apartments. All winter long, we have wire baskets of food hanging about on the trees, and then there is a big basin in which the water is kept from freezing by an electric heater. Summer and winter, food, drink, and shelter are on hand for the birds. We have hatched pheasants and quail in incubators and then turned them over to electric brooders. We have all kinds of birdhouses and nests. The sparrows, who are great abusers of hospitality, insist that their nests be immovable, that they do not sway in the wind. The wrens like swaying nests, so we mounted a number of wren boxes on strips of spring steel so that they would sway in the wind. The wrens liked the idea, and the sparrows did not, so we have been able to have the wrens nest in peace. In summer, we leave cherries on the trees and strawberries open in the beds, and I think that we have not only more, but also more different kinds of bird callers than anywhere else in the northern states. John Burroughs said he thought we had, and one day, when he was staying at our place, he came across a bird that he had never seen before. About 10 years ago, we imported a great number of birds from abroad, yellowhammers, chaffinches, greenfinches, redpales, twites, bullfinches, jays, linnets, larks, some 500 of them. They stayed around a while, but where they are now, I do not know. I shall not import any more. Birds are entitled to live where they want to live. Birds are the best of companions. We need them for their beauty and their companionship, and we also need them for the strictly economic reason that they destroy harmful insects. The only time I ever used the Ford organization to influence legislation was on behalf of the birds, and I think the end justified the means. The Weeks-McLean Bird Bill, providing for bird sanctuaries for our migratory birds, had been hanging in Congress with every likelihood of dying a natural death. Its immediate sponsors could not arouse much interest among the congressmen. Birds do not vote. We got behind that bill, and we asked each of our 6,000 dealers to wire to his representative in Congress. It began to become apparent that birds might have votes. The bill went through. Our organization has never been used for any political purpose and never will be. We assume that our people have a right to their own preferences. To get back to John Burroughs, of course I knew who he was and I had read nearly everything he had written, but I had never thought of meeting him until some years ago, when he developed a grudge against modern progress. He detested money, and especially he detested the power which money gives to vulgar people to despoil the lovely countryside. He grew to dislike the industry out of which money is made. He disliked the noise of factories and railways. He criticized industrial progress, and he declared that the automobile was going to kill the appreciation of nature. I fundamentally disagreed with him. I thought that his emotions had taken him on the wrong track, and so I sent him an automobile with the request that he try it out and discover for himself whether it would not help him to know nature better. That automobile, and it took him some time to learn how to manage it himself, completely changed his point of view. He found that it helped him to see more, and from the time of getting it, he made nearly all of his bird hunting expeditions behind the steering wheel. He learned that instead of having to confine himself to a few miles around slab sides, the whole countryside was open to him. Out of that automobile grew our friendship, and it was a fine one. No man could help being the better for knowing John Burroughs. He was not a professional naturalist, nor did he make sentiment to do for hard research. It is easy to grow sentimental out of doors. It is hard to pursue the truth about a bird as one would pursue a mechanical principle. But John Burroughs did that, and as a result, the observations he set down were very largely accurate. He was impatient with men who were not accurate in their observations of natural life. John Burroughs first loved nature for its own sake. It was not merely his stock of material as a professional writer. He loved it before he wrote about it. Late in life, he turned philosopher. His philosophy was not so much a philosophy of nature as it was a natural philosophy. The long, serene thoughts of a man who had lived in the tranquil spirit of the trees. He was not a pagan, he was not a pantheist, but he did not much divide between nature and human nature, nor between human nature and divine. John Burroughs lived a wholesome life. He was fortunate to have as his home the farm on which he was born. Through long years, his surroundings were those which made for quietness of mind. He loved the woods, and he made dusty-minded city people love them, too. He helped them see what he saw. He did not make much beyond a living. He could have done so, perhaps, but that was not his aim. Like another American naturalist, his occupation could have been described as inspector of birds' nests and hillside paths. Of course, that does not pay in dollars and cents. When he had passed the 70, he changed his views on industry. Perhaps I had something to do with that. He came to see that the whole world could not live by hunting birds' nests. At one time in his life, he had a grudge against all modern progress, especially where it was associated with the burning of coal and the noise of traffic. Perhaps that was as near to literary affectation as he ever came. Wordsworth disliked railways, too, and Thoreau said that he could see more of the country by walking. Perhaps it was influences such as these which bent John Burroughs for a time against industrial progress, but only for a time. He came to see that it was fortunate for him that others' tastes ran in other channels, just as it was fortunate for the world that his taste ran in its own channel. There has been no observable development in the method of making birds' nests since the beginning of recorded observation, but that was hardly a reason why human beings should not prefer modern sanitary homes to cave dwellings. This was a part of John Burroughs' sanity. He was not afraid to change his views. He was a lover of nature, not her dupe. In the course of time, he came to value and approve modern devices, and though this by itself is an interesting fact, it is not so interesting as the fact that he made this change after he was 70 years old. John Burroughs was never too old to change. He kept growing to the last. The man who is too set to change is dead already. The funeral is a mere detail. If he talked more of one person than another, it was Emerson. Not only did he know Emerson by heart as an author, but he knew him by heart as a spirit. He taught me to know Emerson. He had so saturated himself with Emerson that at one time he thought as he did and even fell into his mode of expression. But afterward, he found his own way, which for him was better. There was no sadness in John Burroughs' death. When the grain lies brown and ripe under the harvest sun, and the harvesters are busy binding it into sheaves, there is no sadness for the grain. It has ripened and has fulfilled its term, and so had John Burroughs. With him it was full ripeness and harvest, not decay. He worked almost to the end. His plans ran beyond the end. They buried him among the scenes he loved, and it was his 84th birthday. Those scenes will be preserved as he loved them. John Burroughs, Edison, and I with Harvey S. Firestone made several vagabond trips together. We went in motor caravans and slept under canvas. Once we gypsied through the Adirondacks and again through the Alleghenies, heading southward. The trips were good fun, except that they began to attract too much attention. Today, I am more opposed to war than I ever was, and I think the people of the world know, even if the politicians do not, that war never settles anything. It was war that made the orderly and profitable processes of the world what they are today, a loose, disjointed mass. Of course, some men get rich out of war, others get poor. But the men who get rich are not those who fought or who really helped behind the lines. No patriot makes money out of war. No man with true patriotism could make money out of war, out of the sacrifice of other men's lives. Until the soldier makes money by fighting, until mothers make money by giving their sons to death, not until then should any citizen make money out of providing his country with the means to preserve its life. If wars are to continue, it will be harder and harder for the upright businessman to regard war as a legitimate means of high and speedy profits. War fortunes are losing caste every day. Every greed will someday hesitate before the overwhelming unpopularity and opposition which will meet the war profiteer. Business should be on the side of peace, because peace is business's best asset. And, by the way, was inventive genius ever so sterile as it was during the war? An impartial investigation of the last war, of what preceded it, and what has come out of it, will show beyond a doubt that there is in the world a group of men with vast powers of control, that prefers to remain unknown, that does not seek office or any of the tokens of power, that belongs to no nation whatever, but is international. A force that uses every government, every widespread business organization, every agency of publicity, every resource of national psychology, to throw the world into a panic for the sake of getting still more power over the world. An old gambling trick used to be for the gambler to cry police when a lot of money was on the table, and in the panic that followed, to seize the money and run off with it. There is a power within the world which cries war, and in the confusion of the nations, the unrestrained sacrifice which people make for safety and peace runs off with the spoils of the panic. The point to keep in mind is that, though we won the military contest, the world has not yet quite succeeded in winning a complete victory over the promoters of war. We ought not to forget that wars are a purely manufactured evil and are made according to a definite technique. A campaign for war is made upon as definite lines as a campaign for any other purpose. First, the people are worked upon. By clever tales, the people's suspicions are aroused toward the nation against whom war is desired. Make the nation suspicious. Make the other nation suspicious. All you need for this is a few agents with some cleverness and no conscience and a press whose interest is locked up with the interest that will be benefited by war. Then the overt act will soon appear. It is no trick at all to get an overt act once you work the hatred of two nations up to the proper pitch. There were men in every country who were glad to see the World War begin and sorry to see it stop. Hundreds of American fortunes date from the Civil War. Thousands of new fortunes date from the World War. Nobody can deny that war is a profitable business for those who like that kind of money. War is an orgy of money, just as it is an orgy of blood. And we should not so easily be led into war if we considered what it is that makes a nation really great. It is not the amount of trade that makes a nation great. The creation of private fortunes, like the creation of an autocracy, does not make any country great. Nor does the mere change of an agricultural population into a factory population. A country becomes great when, by the wise development of its resources and the skill of its people, property is widely and fairly distributed. Foreign trade is full of delusions. We ought to wish for every nation as large a degree of self-support as possible. Instead of wishing to keep them dependent on us for what we manufacture, we should wish them to learn to manufacture themselves and build up a solidly founded civilization. When every nation learns to produce the things which it can produce, we shall be able to get down to a basis of serving each other along those special lines in which there can be no competition. The North Temperate Zone will never be able to compete with the tropics in the special products of the tropics. Our country will never be a competitor with the Orient in the production of tea, nor with the South in the production of rubber. A large proportion of our foreign trade is based on the backwardness of our foreign customers. Selfishness is a motive that would preserve that backwardness. Humanity is a motive that would help the backward nations to a self-supporting basis. Take Mexico, for example. We have heard a great deal about the development of Mexico. Exploitation is the word that ought instead to be used. When its rich natural resources are exploited for the increase of the private fortunes of foreign capitalists, that is not development. It is ravishment. You can never develop Mexico until you develop the Mexican. And yet, how much of the development of Mexico by foreign exploiters ever took account of the development of its people? The Mexican peon has been regarded as mere fuel for the foreign money makers. Foreign trade has been his degradation. Short-sighted people are afraid of such counsel. They say, "What would become of our foreign trade?" When the natives of Africa began raising their own cotton, and the natives of Russia began making their own farming implements, and the natives of China began supplying their own wants, it will make a difference, to be sure. But does any thoughtful man imagine that the world can long continue on the present basis of a few nations supplying the needs of the world? We must think in terms of what the world will be when civilization becomes general, when all the peoples have learned to help themselves. When a country goes mad about foreign trade, it usually depends on other countries for its raw material, turns its population into factory fodder, creates a rich private class, and lets its own immediate interest lie neglected. Here in the United States, we have enough work to do developing our own country to relieve us of the necessity of looking for foreign trade for a long time. We have agriculture enough to feed us while we are doing it, and money enough to carry the job through. Is there anything more stupid than the United States standing idle because Japan or France or any other country has not sent us an order when there is a 100-year job awaiting us in developing our own country? Commerce began in service. Men carried off their surplus to people who had none. The country that raised corn carried it to the country that could raise no corn. The lumber country brought wood to the treeless plain. The vine country brought fruit to cold northern climes. The pasture country brought meat to the grassless region. It was all service. When all the peoples of the world become developed in the art of self-support, commerce will get back to that basis. Business will once more become service. There will be no competition because the basis of competition will have vanished. The varied peoples will develop skills which will be in the nature of monopolies and not competitive. From the beginning, the races have exhibited distinct strains of genius, this one for government, another for colonization, another for the sea, another for art and music, another for agriculture, another for business, and so on. Lincoln said that this nation could not survive half slave and half free. The human race cannot forever exist half exploiter and half exploited. Until we become buyers and sellers alike, producers and consumers alike, keeping the balance not for profit but for service, we are going to have topsy-turvy conditions. France has something to give the world of which no competition can cheat her. So has Italy. So has Russia. So have the countries of South America. So has Japan. So has Britain. So has the United States. The sooner we get back to a basis of natural specialties and drop this free-for-all system of grab, the sooner we shall be sure of international self-respect and international peace. Trying to take the trade of the world can promote war. It cannot promote prosperity. Someday, even the international bankers will learn this. I have never been able to discover any honorable reasons for the beginning of the World War. It seems to have grown out of a very complicated situation created largely by those who thought that they could profit by war. I believed, on the information that was given to me in 1916, that some of the nations were anxious for peace and would welcome a demonstration for peace. It was in the hope that this was true that I financed the expedition to Stockholm in what has since been called the peace ship. I do not regret the attempt. The mere fact that it failed is not, to me, conclusive proof that it was not worth trying. We learn more from our failures than from our successes. What I learned on that trip was worth the time and the money expended. I do not know whether the information as conveyed to me was true or false. I do not care. But I think everyone will agree that if it had been possible to end the war in 1916, the world would be better off than it is today. For the victors wasted themselves in winning, and the vanquished in resisting. Nobody got an advantage, honorable or dishonorable, out of that war. I had hoped, finally, when the United States entered the war, that it might be a war to end wars, but now I know that wars do not end wars any more than an extraordinarily large conflagration does away with the fire hazard. When our country entered the war, it became the duty of every citizen to do his utmost towards seeing through to the end that which we had undertaken. I believe that it is the duty of the man who opposes war to oppose going to war up until the time of its actual declaration. My opposition to war is not based upon pacifist or non-resistant principles. It may be that the present state of civilization is such that certain international questions cannot be discussed. It may be that they have to be fought out. But the fighting never settles the question. It only gets the participants around to a frame of mind where they will agree to discuss what they were fighting about. Once we were in the war, every facility of the Ford industries was put at the disposal of the government. We had, up to the time of the declaration of war, absolutely refused to take war orders from the foreign belligerents. It is entirely out of keeping with the principles of our business to disturb the routine of our production unless it is an emergency. It is at variance with our human principles to aid either side in a war in which our country was not involved. These principles had no application once the United States entered the war. From April 1917 until November 1918, our factory worked practically exclusively for the government. Of course, we made cars and parts and special delivery trucks and ambulances as a part of our general production, but we also made many other articles that were more or less new to us. We made 2.5-ton and 6-ton trucks. We made Liberty mortars in great quantities, aero cylinders, 1.55mm and 4.7mm caissons. We made listening devices, steel helmets, both at Highland Park and Philadelphia, and Eagle boats. And we did a large amount of experimental work on armor plate, compensators, and body armor. For the Eagle boats, we put up a special plant on the River Rouge site. These boats were designed to combat the submarines. They were 204 feet long, made of steel, and one of the conditions precedent to their building was that their construction should not interfere with any other line of war production, and also that they be delivered quickly. The design was worked out by the Navy Department. On December 22, 1917, I offered to build the boats for the Navy. The discussion terminated on January 15, 1918, when the Navy Department awarded the contract to the Ford Company. On July 11th, the first completed boat was launched. We made both the hulls and the engines, and not a forging or a rolled beam entered into the construction of other than the engine. We stamped the hulls entirely out of sheet steel. They were built indoors. In 4 months, we ran up a building at the River Rouge, a third of a mile long, 350 feet wide, and 100 feet high, covering more than 13 acres. These boats were not built by marine engineers. They were built simply by applying our production principles to a new product. With the armistice, we at once dropped the war and went back to peace. An able man is a man who can do things, and his ability to do things is dependent on what he has in him. What he has in him depends on what he started with and what he has done to increase and discipline it. An educated man is not one whose memory is trained to carry a few dates in history. He is one who can accomplish things. A man who cannot think is not an educated man, however many college degrees he may have acquired. Thinking is the hardest work anyone can do, which is probably the reason why we have so few thinkers. There are two extremes to be avoided. One is the attitude of contempt towards education. The other is the tragic snobbery of assuming that marching through an educational system is a sure cure for ignorance and mediocrity. You cannot learn in any school what the world is going to do next year, but you can learn some of the things which the world has tried to do in former years, and where it failed and where it succeeded. If education consisted in warning the young student away from some of the false theories on which men have tried to build, so that he may be saved the loss of the time in finding out by bitter experience, its good would be unquestioned. An education which consists of signposts indicating the failure and the fallacies of the past doubtless would be very useful. It is not education just to possess the theories of a lot of professors. Speculation is very interesting and sometimes profitable, but it is not education. To be learned in science today is merely to be aware of 100 theories that have not been proved. And not to know what those theories are is to be uneducated, ignorant, and so forth. If knowledge of guesses is learning, then one may become learned by the simple expedient of making his own guesses. And by the same token, he can dub the rest of the world ignorant because it does not know what his guesses are. But the best that education can do for a man is to put him in possession of his powers, give him control of the tools which destiny has endowed him, and teach him how to think. The college renders its best service as an intellectual gymnasium, in which mental muscle is developed, and the student strengthened to do what he can. To say, however, that mental gymnastics can be had only in college is not true, as every educator knows. A man's real education begins after he has left school. True education is gained through the discipline of life. There are many kinds of knowledge, and it depends on what crowd you happen to be in, or how the fashions of the day happen to be run, which kind of knowledge is most respected at the moment. There are fashions in knowledge, just as there are in everything else. When some of us were lads, knowledge used to be limited to the Bible. There were certain men in the neighborhood who knew the book thoroughly, and they were looked up to and respected. Biblical knowledge was highly valued then, but nowadays it is doubtful whether deep acquaintance with the Bible would be sufficient to win a man a name for learning. Knowledge, to my mind, is something that in the past somebody knew and left in a form which enables all who will to obtain it. If a man is born with normal human faculties, if he is equipped with enough ability to use the tools which we call letters in reading or writing, there is no knowledge within the possession of the race that he cannot have, if he wants it. The only reason why every man does not know everything that the human mind has ever learned is that no one has ever yet found it worthwhile to know that much. Men satisfy their minds more by finding things out for themselves than by heaping together the things which somebody else has found out. You can go out and gather knowledge all your life, and with all your gathering, you will not catch up even with your own times. You may fill your head with all the facts of all the ages, and your head may be just an overloaded fact box when you get through. The point is this: great piles of knowledge in the head are not the same as mental activity. A man may be very learned and very useless, and then again, a man may be unlearned and very useful. The object of education is not to fill a man's mind with facts. It is to teach him how to use his mind in thinking. And it often happens that a man can think better if he is not hampered by the knowledge of the past. It is a very human tendency to think that what mankind does not yet know, no one can learn. And yet it must be perfectly clear to everyone that the past learning of mankind cannot be allowed to hinder our future learning. Mankind has not gone so very far when you measure its progress against the knowledge that is yet to be gained, the secrets that are yet to be learned. One good way to hinder progress is to fill a man's head with all the learning of the past. It makes him feel that because his head is full, there is nothing more to learn. Merely gathering knowledge may become the most useless work a man can do. What can you do to help and heal the world? That is the educational test. If a man can hold up his own end, he counts for one. If he can help 10 or 100 or 1,000 other men hold up their ends, he counts for more. He may be quite rusty on many things that inhabit the realm of print, but he is a learned man just the same. When a man is master of his own sphere, whatever it may be, he has won his degree. He has entered the realm of wisdom. The work which we describe as studies in the Jewish question, and which is variously described by antagonists as the Jewish campaign, the attack on the Jews, the anti-Semitic pogrom, and so forth, needs no explanation to those who have followed it. Its motives and purposes must be judged by the work itself. It is offered as a contribution to a question which deeply affects the country, a question which is racial at its source, and which concerns influences and ideals rather than persons. Our statements must be judged by candid readers who are intelligent enough to lay our words alongside life as they are able to observe it. If our word and their observation agree, the case is made. It is perfectly silly to begin to damn us before it has been shown that our statements are baseless or reckless. The first item to be considered is the truth of what we have set forth, and that is precisely the item which our critics choose to evade. Readers of our articles will see at once that we are not actuated by any kind of prejudice, except it may be a prejudice in favor of the principles which have made our civilization. There had been observed in this country certain streams of influence which were causing a marked deterioration in our literature, amusements, and social conduct. Business was departing from its old-time substantial soundness. A general letting down of standards was felt everywhere. It was not the robust coarseness of the white man, the rude indelicacy, say, of Shakespeare's characters, but a nasty Orientalism which has insidiously affected every channel of expression, and to such an extent that it was time to challenge it. The fact that these influences are all traceable to one racial source is a fact to be reckoned with, not by us only, but by the intelligent people of the race in question. It is entirely creditable to them that steps have been taken by them to remove their protection from the more flagrant violators of American hospitality. But there is still room to discard outworn ideas of racial superiority maintained by economic or intellectually subversive warfare upon Christian society. Our work does not pretend to say the last word on the Jew in America. It says only the word which describes his obvious present impress on the country. When that impress is changed, the report of it can be changed. For the present, then, the question is wholly in the Jews' hands. If they are as wise as they claim to be, they will labor to make Jews American instead of laboring to make America Jewish. The genius of the United States of America is Christian in the broadest sense, and its destiny is to remain Christian. This carries no sectarian meaning with it, but relates to a basic principle, which differs from other principles in that it provides for liberty with morality and pledges society to a code of relations based on fundamental Christian conceptions of human rights and duties. As for prejudice or hatred against persons, that is neither American nor Christian. Our opposition is only to ideas, false ideas, which are sapping the moral stamina of the people. These ideas proceed from easily identified sources, they are promulgated by easily discoverable methods, and they are controlled by mere exposure. We have simply used the method of exposure. When people learn to identify the source and nature of the influence swirling about them, it is sufficient. Let the American people once understand that it is not natural degeneracy, but calculated subversion that afflicts us, and they are safe. The explanation is the cure. This work was taken up without personal motives. When it reached a stage where we believe the American people could grasp the key, we let it rest for the time. Our enemies say that we began it for revenge and that we laid it down in fear. Time will show that our critics are merely dealing in evasion because they dare not tackle the main question. Time will also show that we are better friends to the Jews' best interests than those are who praise them to their faces and criticize them behind their backs. End of chapter 17.
Chapter 18. Democracy and Industry. Perhaps no word is more overworked nowadays than the word democracy, and those who shout loudest about it, I think, as a rule, want it least. I am always suspicious of men who speak glibly of democracy. I wonder if they want to set up some kind of a despotism, or if they want to have somebody do for them what they ought to do for themselves. I am for the kind of democracy that gives to each an equal chance according to his ability. I think if we give more attention to serving our fellows, we shall have less concern with the empty forms of government and more concern with the things to be done. Thinking of service, we shall not bother about good feeling in industry or life. We shall not bother about masses and classes, or closed and open shops, and such matters as have nothing at all to do with the real business of living. We can get down to facts. We stand in need of facts. It is a shock when the mind awakens to the fact that not all of humanity is human, that whole groups of people do not regard others with humane feelings. Great efforts have been made to have this appear as the attitude of a class, but it is really the attitude of all classes, insofar as they are swayed by the false notion of classes. Before, when it was the constant effort of propaganda to make the people believe that it was only the rich who were without humane feelings, the opinion became general that among the poor the humane virtues flourished. But the rich and the poor are both very small minorities, and you cannot classify society under such heads. There are not enough rich, and there are not enough poor to serve the purpose of such classification. Rich men have become poor without changing their natures, and poor men have become rich, and the problem has not been affected by it. Between the rich and the poor is the great mass of the people, who are neither rich nor poor. A society made up exclusively of millionaires would not be different from our present society. Some of the millionaires would have to raise wheat and bake bread and make machinery and run trains, else they would all starve to death. Someone must do the work. Really, we have no fixed classes. We have men who will work and men who will not. Most of the classes that one reads about are purely fictional. Take certain capitalist papers. You will be amazed by some of the statements about the laboring class. We who have been and still are part of the laboring class know that the statements are untrue. Take certain of the labor papers. You are equally amazed by some of the statements they make about capitalists, and yet on both sides there is a grain of truth. The man who is a capitalist and nothing else, who gambles with the fruits of other men's labors, deserves all that is said against him. He is in precisely the same class as the cheap gambler who cheats working men out of their wages. The statements we read about the laboring class in the capitalistic press are seldom written by managers of great industries, but by a class of writers who are writing what they think will please their employers. They write what they imagine will please. Examine the labor press and you will find another class of writers who similarly seek to tickle the prejudices which they conceive the laboring man to have. Both kinds of writers are mere propagandists, and propaganda that does not spread facts is self-destructive, and it should be. You cannot preach patriotism to men for the purpose of getting them to stand still while you rob them, and get away with that kind of preaching very long. You cannot preach the duty of working hard and producing plentifully and make that a screen for an additional profit to yourself. And neither can the worker conceal a lack of a day's work by a phrase. Undoubtedly, the employing class possesses facts which the employed ought to have in order to construct sound opinions and pass fair judgments. Undoubtedly, the employed possess facts which are equally important to the employer. It is extremely doubtful, however, if either side has all the facts. And this is where propaganda, even if it were possible for it to be entirely successful, is defective. It is not desirable that one set of ideas be put over on a class holding another set of ideas. What we really need is to get all the ideas together and construct from them. Take, for instance, this whole matter of union labor and the right to strike. The only strong group of union men in the country is the group that draws salaries from the unions. Some of them are very rich. Some of them are interested in influencing the affairs of our large institutions of finance. Others are so extreme in their so-called socialism that they border on Bolshevism and anarchism, their union salaries liberating them from the necessity of work so that they can devote their energies to subversive propaganda. All of them enjoy a certain prestige and power, which, in the natural course of competition, they could not otherwise have won. If the official personnel of the labor unions were as strong, as honest, as decent, and as plainly wise as the bulk of men who make up the membership, the whole movement would have taken on a different complexion these last few years. But this official personnel, in the main, there are notable exceptions, has not devoted itself to an alliance with the naturally strong qualities of the working man. It has rather devoted itself to playing upon his weaknesses, principally
upon the weakness of that newly arrived portion of the population which does not yet know what Americanism is, and which never will know if left to the tutelage of their local union leaders. The working men, except those few who have been inoculated with the fallacious doctrine of the class war, and who have accepted the philosophy that progress consists in fomenting discord in industry, when you get your $12 a day, don't stop at that, agitate for 14. When you get your 8 hours a day, don't be a fool and grow contented, agitate for 6 hours, start something, always start something. Have the plain sense, which enables them to recognize that with principles accepted and observed, conditions change. The union leaders have never seen that. They wish conditions to remain as they are, conditions of injustice, provocation, strikes, bad feeling, and crippled national life. Else, where would be the need for union officers? Every strike is a new argument for them. They point to it and say, "You see, you still need us." The only true labor leader is the one who leads labor to work and to wages, and not the leader who leads labor to strikes, sabotage, and starvation. The union of labor, which is coming to the fore in this country, is the union of all whose interests are interdependent, whose interests are altogether dependent on the usefulness and efficiency of the service they render. There is a change coming. When the union of union leaders disappears, with it will go the union of blind bosses. Bosses who never did a decent thing for their employees until they were compelled. If the blind boss was a disease, the selfish union leader was the antidote. When the union leader became the disease, the blind boss became the antidote. Both are misfits. Both are out of place in well-organized society, and they are both disappearing together. It is the blind boss whose voice is heard today saying, "Now is the time to smash labor. We've got them on the run." That voice is going down to silence with the voice that preaches class war. The producers, from the men at the drawing board to the men on the molding floor, have gotten together in a real union, and they will handle their own affairs henceforth. The exploitation of dissatisfaction is an established business today. Its object is not to settle anything, nor to get anything done, but to keep dissatisfaction in existence. And the instruments used to do this are a whole set of false theories and promises which can never be fulfilled as long as the earth remains what it is. I am not opposed to labor organization. I am not opposed to any sort of organization that makes for progress. It is organizing to limit production, whether by employers or by workers, that matters. The working man himself must be on guard against some very dangerous notions, dangerous to himself and to the welfare of the country. It is sometimes said that the less a worker does, the more jobs he creates for other men. This fallacy assumes that idleness is creative. Idleness never created a job. It creates only burdens. The industrious man never runs his fellow worker out of a job. Indeed, it is the industrious man who is the partner of the industrious manager, who creates more and more business, and therefore more and more jobs. It is a great pity that the idea should ever have gone abroad among sensible men that by soldiering on the job, they help someone else. A moment's thought will show the weakness of such an idea. The healthy business, the business that is always making more and more opportunities for men to earn an honorable and ample living, is the business in which every man does a day's work of which he is proud. And the country that stands most securely is the country in which men work honestly and do not play tricks with the means of production,
We cannot play fast and loose with economic laws because if we do, they handle us in very hard ways. The fact that a piece of work is now being done by 9 men, which used to be done by 10 men, does not mean that the 10th man is unemployed. He is merely not employed on that work, and the public is not carrying the burden of his support by paying more than it ought on that work, for after all, it is the public that pays. An industrial concern, which is wide enough awake to reorganize for efficiency and honest enough with the public to charge it necessary costs and no more, is usually such an enterprising concern that it has plenty of jobs at which to employ the 10th man. It is bound to grow, and growth means jobs. A well-managed concern is always seeking to lower the labor cost to the public, and it is certain to employ more men than the concern which loafs along and makes the public pay the cost of its mismanagement. The 10th man was an unnecessary cost. The ultimate consumer was paying him. But the fact that he was unnecessary on that particular job does not mean that he is unnecessary in the work of the world, or even in the work of his particular shop. The public pays for all mismanagement. More than half the trouble with the world today is the soldiering and dilution and cheapness and inefficiency for which the people are paying their good money. Wherever two men are being paid for what one can do, the people are paying double what they ought. And it is a fact that only a little while ago in the United States, man for man, we were not producing what we did for several years previous to the war. A day's work means more than merely being on duty at the shop for the required number of hours. It means giving an equivalent in service for the wage drawn. And when that equivalent is tampered with either way, when the man gives more than he receives, or receives more than he gives, it is not long before serious dislocation will be manifest. Extend that condition throughout the country, and you have a complete upset of business. All that industrial difficulty means is the destruction of basic equivalents in the shop. Management must share the blame with labor. Management has been lazy, too. Management has found it easier to hire an additional 500 men than to so improve its methods that 100 men of the old force could be released to other work. The public was paying, and business was booming, and management didn't care a pin. It was no different in the office from what it was in the shop. The law of equivalence was broken just as much by managers as by workmen. Practically nothing of importance is secured by mere demand. That is why strikes always fail, even though they may seem to succeed. A strike which brings higher wages or shorter hours and passes on the burden to the community is really unsuccessful. It only makes the industry less able to serve and decreases the number of jobs that it can support. This is not to say that no strike is justified. It may draw attention to an evil. Men can strike with justice. That they will thereby get justice is another question. The strike for proper conditions and just rewards is justifiable. The pity is that men should be compelled to use the strike to get what is theirs by right. No American ought to be compelled to strike for his rights. He ought to receive them naturally, easily, as a matter of course. These justifiable strikes are usually the employer's fault. Some employers are not fit for their job. The employment of men, the direction of their energies, the arranging of their rewards in honest ratio to their production and to the prosperity of the business, is no small job. An employer may be unfit for his job, just as a man at the lathe may be unfit. Justifiable strikes are a sign that the boss needs another job, one that he can handle.
The unfit employer causes more trouble than the unfit employee. You can change the latter to another more suitable job, but the former must usually be left to the law of compensation. The justified strike, then, is one that need never have been called if the employer had done his work. There is a second kind of strike, the strike with a concealed design. In this kind of strike, the working men are made the tools of some manipulator who seeks his own ends through them. To illustrate, here is a great industry whose success is due to having met a public need with efficient and skillful production. It has a record for justice. Such an industry presents a great temptation to speculators. If they can only gain control of it, they can reap rich benefit from all the honest effort that has been put into it. They can destroy its beneficiary wage and profit sharing, squeeze every last dollar out of the public, the product, and the working man, and reduce it to the plight of other business concerns which are run on low principles. The motive may be the personal greed of the speculators, or they may want to change the policy of a business because its example is embarrassing to other employers who do not want to do what is right. The industry cannot be touched from within because its men have no reason to strike. So another method is adopted. The business may keep many outside shops busy supplying it with material. If these outside shops can be tied up, then that great industry may be crippled. So strikes are fomented in the outside industries. Every attempt is made to curtail the factory's source of supplies. If the working men in the outside shops knew what the game was, they would refuse to play it, but they don't know. They serve as the tools of designing capitalists without knowing it. There is one point, however, that ought to rouse the suspicions of working men engaged in this kind of strike. If the strike cannot get itself settled, no matter what either side offers to do, it is almost positive proof that there is a third party interested in having the strike continue. That hidden influence does not want a settlement on any terms. If such a strike is won by the strikers, is the lot of the working man improved? After throwing the industry into the hands of outside speculators, are the workmen given any better treatment or wages? There is a third kind of strike, the strike that is provoked by the money interests for the purpose of giving labor a bad name. The American workman has always had a reputation for sound judgment. He has not allowed himself to be led away by every shouter who promised to create the millennium out of thin air. He has had a mind of his own and has used it. He has always recognized the fundamental truth that the absence of reason was never made good by the presence of violence. In his way, the American workingman has won a certain prestige with his own people and throughout the world. Public opinion has been inclined to regard with respect his opinions and desires. But there seems to be a determined effort to fashion the Bolshevik stain on American labor by inciting it to such impossible attitudes and such wholly unheard-of actions as shall change public sentiment from respect to criticism. Merely avoiding strikes, however, does not promote industry. We may say to the working man, "You have a grievance, but the strike is no remedy. It only makes the situation worse, whether you win or lose." Then the working man may admit this to be true and refrain from striking. Does that settle anything? No. If the worker abandons strikes as an unworthy means of bringing about desirable conditions, it simply means that employers must get busy on their own initiative and correct defective conditions. The experience of the Ford Industries with the working man has been entirely satisfactory, both in the United States and abroad. We have no antagonism to unions.
but we participate in no arrangements with either employee or employer organizations. The wages paid are always higher than any reasonable union could think of demanding, and the hours of work are always shorter. There is nothing that a union membership could do for our people. Some of them may belong to unions, probably the majority do not. We do not know and make no attempts to find out, for it is a matter of not the slightest concern to us. We respect the unions, sympathize with their good aims, and denounce their bad ones. In turn, I think that they give us respect, for there has never been any authoritative attempt to come between the men and the management in our plants. Of course, radical agitators have tried to stir up trouble now and again, but the men have mostly regarded them simply as human oddities, and their interest in them has been the same sort of interest that they would have in a four-legged man. In England, we did not meet the trades union question squarely in our Manchester plant. The workmen of Manchester are mostly unionized, and the usual English union restrictions upon output prevail. We took over a body plant in which were a number of union carpenters. At once, the union officers asked to see our executives and arrange terms. We deal only with our own employees and never with outside representatives, so our people refused to see the union officials. Thereupon, they called the carpenters out on strike. The carpenters would not strike and were expelled from the union. Then the expelled men brought suit against the union for their share of the benefit fund. I do not know how the litigation turned out, but that was the end of interference by trades union officers with our operations in England. We make no attempt to coddle the people who work with us. It is absolutely a give-and-take relation. During the period in which we largely increased wages, we did have a considerable supervisory force. The home life of the men was investigated, and an effort was made to find out what they did with their wages. Perhaps at the time it was necessary. It gave us valuable information. But it would not do at all as a permanent affair, and it has been abandoned. We do not believe in the glad hand, or the professionalized personal touch, or human element. It is too late in the day for that sort of thing. Men want something more than a worthy sentiment. Social conditions are not made out of words. They are the net result of the daily relations between man and man. The best social spirit is evidenced by some act which costs the management something and which benefits all. That is the only way to prove good intentions and win respect. Propaganda, bulletins, lectures, they are nothing. It is the right act sincerely done that counts. A great business is really too big to be human. It grows so large as to supplant the personality of the man. In a big business, the employer, like the employee, is lost in the mass. Together, they have created a great productive organization which sends out articles that the world buys and pays for in return money that provides a livelihood for everyone in the business. The business itself becomes the big thing. There is something sacred about a big business which provides a living for hundreds and thousands of families. When one looks about at their babies coming into the world, at the boys and girls going to school, at the young working men who, on the strength of their jobs, are marrying and setting up for themselves, at the thousands of homes that are being paid for on installments out of the earnings of men. When one looks at a great productive organization that is enabling all these things to be done, then the continuance of that business becomes a holy trust. It becomes greater and more important than the individuals. The employer is but a man, like his employees, and is subject to all the limitations of humanity.
he is justified in holding his job only as he can fill it. If he can steer the business straight, if his men can trust him to run his end of the work properly and without endangering their security, then he is filling his place. Otherwise, he is no more fit for his position than would be an infant. The employer, like everyone else, is to be judged solely by his ability. He may be but a name to the men, a name on a signboard. But there is the business. It is more than a name. It produces the living, and a living is a pretty tangible thing. The business is a reality. It does things. It is a going concern. The evidence of its fineness is that the pay envelopes keep coming. You can hardly have too much harmony in business, but you can go too far in picking men because they harmonize. You can have so much harmony that there will not be enough of the thrust and counter-thrust, which is life, enough of the competition, which means effort and progress. It is one thing for an organization to be working harmoniously toward one object, but it is another thing for an organization to work harmoniously with each individual unit of itself. Some organizations use up so much energy and time maintaining a feeling of harmony that they have no force left to work for the object for which the organization was created. The organization is secondary to the object. The only harmonious organization that is worth anything is an organization in which all the members are bent on the one main purpose, to get along toward the objective. A common purpose, honestly believed in, sincerely desired, that is the great harmonizing principle. I pity the poor fellow who is so soft and flabby that he must always have an atmosphere of good feeling around him before he can do his work. There are such men, and in the end, unless they obtain enough mental and moral hardiness to lift them out of their soft reliance on feeling, they are failures. Not only are they business failures, they are character failures also. It is as if their bones never attained a sufficient degree of hardness to enable them to stand on their own feet. There is altogether too much reliance on good feeling in our business organizations. People have too great a fondness for working with the people they like. In the end, it spoils a good many valuable qualities. Do not misunderstand me. When I use the term good feeling, I mean that habit of making one's personal likes and dislikes the sole standard of judgment. Suppose you do not like a man. Is that anything against him? It may be something against you. What have your likes or dislikes to do with the facts? Every man of common sense knows that there are men whom he dislikes who are really more capable than he is himself. And taking all of this out of the shop and into the broader fields, it is not necessary for the rich to love the poor or the poor to love the rich. It is not necessary for the employer to love the employee or for the employee to love the employer. What is necessary is that each should try to do justice to the other according to his deserts. That is real democracy, and not the question of who ought to own the bricks and the mortar and the furnaces and the mills. And democracy has nothing to do with the question, who ought to be the boss? That is very much like saying, who ought to be the tenor in the quartet? Obviously, the man who can sing tenor. You could not have deposed Caruso. Suppose some theory of musical democracy had consigned Caruso to the musical proletariat. Would that have reared another tenor to take his place? Or would Caruso's gifts have still remained his own? End of chapter 18.
Chapter 19. What We May Expect. We are, unless I do not read the signs aright, in the midst of a change. It is going on all about us, slowly and scarcely observed, but with a firm surety,
We are gradually learning to relate cause and effect. A great deal of that which we call disturbance, a great deal of the upset in what we have seemed to be established institutions, is really but the surface indication of something approaching a regeneration. The public point of view is changing, and we really need only a somewhat different point of view to make the very bad system of the past into a very good system of the future. We are displacing that peculiar virtue which used to be admired as hard-headedness and which was really only wooden-headedness with intelligence, and also we are getting rid of mushy sentimentalism. The first confused hardness with progress. The second confused softness with progress. We are getting a better view of the realities and are beginning to know that we have already in the world all things needful for the fullest kind of a life, and that we shall use them better once we learn what they are and what they mean. Whatever is wrong, and we all know that much is wrong, can be righted by a clear definition of the wrongness. We have been looking so much at one another, at what one has and another lacks, and we have made a personal affair out of something that is too big for personalities. To be sure, human nature enters largely into our economic problems. Selfishness exists, and doubtless it colors all the competitive activities of life. If selfishness were the characteristic of any one class, it might be easily dealt with, but it is in human fiber everywhere, and greed exists, and envy exists, and jealousy exists. But as the struggle for mere existence grows less, and it is less than it used to be, although the sense of uncertainty may have increased, we have an opportunity to release some of the finer motives. We think less of the frills of civilization as we grow used to them. Progress, as the world has thus far known it, is accompanied by a great increase in the things of life. There is more gear, more wrought material, in the average American backyard than the whole domain of an African king. The average American boy has more paraphernalia around him than a whole Eskimo community. The utensils of a kitchen, dining room, bedroom, and coal cellar make a list that would have staggered the most luxurious potentate of 500 years ago. The increase in the impedimenta of life only marks a stage. We are like the Indian who comes into a town with all his money and buys everything he sees. There is no adequate realization of the large proportion of the labor and material of industry that is used in furnishing the world with its trumpery and trinkets, which are made only to be sold, and are bought merely to be owned, that perform no service in the world, and are at last mere rubbish, as at first they were mere waste. Humanity is advancing out of its trinket-making stage, and industry is coming down to meet the world's needs. And thus we may expect further advancement toward that life which many now see, but which the present good enough stage hinders our attaining. And we are growing out of this worship of material possessions. It is no longer a distinction to be rich. As a matter of fact, to be rich is no longer a common ambition. People do not care for money as money as they once did. Certainly, they do not stand in awe of it, nor of him who possesses it. What we accumulate by way of useless surplus does us no honor. It takes only a moment's thought to see that, as far as individual personal advantage is concerned, vast accumulations of money mean nothing. A human being is a human being, and is nourished by the same amount and quality of food, is warmed by the same weight of clothing, whether he be rich or poor, and no one can inhabit more than one room at a time. But if one has visions of service, if one has vast plans which no ordinary resources could possibly realize,
if one has a life ambition to make the industrial desert bloom like the rose, and the workaday life suddenly blossom into fresh and enthusiastic human motives of higher character and efficiency, then one sees in large sums of money what the farmer sees in his seed corn, the beginning of new and richer harvests, whose benefits can no more be selfishly confined than can the sun's rays. There are two fools in this world. One is the millionaire, who thinks that by hoarding money he can somehow accumulate real power, and the other is the penniless reformer, who thinks that if only he can take the money from one class and give it to another, all the world's ills will be cured. They are both on the wrong track. They might as well try to corner all the checkers or all the dominoes of the world under the delusion that they are thereby cornering great quantities of skill. Some of the most successful money makers of our times have never added one pennyworth to the wealth of men. Does a card player add to the wealth of the world? If we all created wealth up to the limits, the easy limits, of our creative capacity, then it would simply be a case of there being enough for everybody, and everybody getting enough. Any real scarcity of the necessaries of life in the world, not a fictitious scarcity caused by the lack of clinking metallic discs in one's purse, is due only to lack of production, and lack of production is due only too often to lack of knowledge of how and what to produce. This much we must believe as a starting point, that the earth produces, or is capable of producing, enough to give decent sustenance to everyone, not of food alone, but of everything else we need, for everything is produced from the earth, that it is possible for labor, production, distribution, and reward to be so organized as to make certain that those who contribute shall receive shares determined by an exact justice. That regardless of the frailties of human nature, our economic system can be so adjusted that selfishness, although perhaps not abolished, can be robbed of power to work serious economic injustice. The business of life is easy or hard according to the skill or the lack of a skill displayed in production and distribution. It has been thought that business existed for profit. That is wrong. Business exists for service. It is a profession and must have recognized professional ethics to violate which declasses a man. Business needs more of the professional spirit. The professional spirit seeks professional integrity from pride, not from compulsion. The professional spirit detects its own violations and penalizes them. Business will someday become clean. A machine that stops every little while is an imperfect machine, and its imperfection is within itself. A body that falls sick every little while is a diseased body, and its disease is within itself. So with business, its faults, many of them purely the faults of the moral constitution of business, clog its progress and make it sick every little while. Someday, the ethics of business will be universally recognized, and in that day, business will be seen to be the oldest and most useful of all the professions. All that the Ford industries have done, all that I have done, is to endeavor to evidence by works that service comes before profit, and the sort of business which makes the world better for its presence is a noble profession. Often it has come to me that what is regarded as the somewhat remarkable progression of our enterprises, I will not say success, for that word is an epitaph, and we are just starting, is due to some accident, and that the methods which we have used, while well enough in their way, fit only the making of our particular products and would not do at all in any other line of business,
or indeed for any products or personalities other than our own. It used to be taken for granted that our theories and our methods were fundamentally unsound. That is because they were not understood. Events have killed that kind of comment, but there remains a wholly sincere belief that what we have done could not be done by any other company, that we have been touched by a wand, that neither we nor anyone else could make shoes, or hats, or sewing machines, or watches, or typewriters, or any other necessity, after the manner in which we make automobiles and tractors, and that if only we ventured into other fields, we should right quickly discover our errors. I do not agree with any of this. Nothing has come out of the air. The foregoing pages should prove that. We have nothing that others might not have. We have had no good fortune, except that which always attends anyone who puts his best into his work. There was nothing that could be called favorable about our beginning. We began with almost nothing. What we have, we earned, and we earned it by unremitting labor and faith in a principle. We took what was a luxury and turned it into a necessity without trick or subterfuge. When we began to make our present motor car, the country had few good roads, gasoline was scarce, and the idea was firmly implanted in the public mind that an automobile was, at the best, a rich man's toy. Our only advantage was lack of precedent. We began to manufacture according to a creed which was at that time unknown in business. The new is always thought odd, and some of us are so constituted that we can never get over thinking that anything which is new must be odd and probably queer. The mechanical working out of our creed is constantly changing. We are continually finding new and better ways of putting it into practice, but we have not found it necessary to alter the principles, and I cannot imagine how it might ever be necessary to alter them, because I hold that they are absolutely universal and must lead to a better and wider life for all. If I did not think so, I would not keep working, for the money that I make is inconsequent. Money is useful only as it serves to forward by practical example the principle that business is justified only as it serves, that it must always give more to the community than it takes away, and that unless everybody benefits by the existence of a business, then that business should not exist. I have proved this with automobiles and tractors. I intend to prove it with railways and public service corporations, not for my personal satisfaction and not for the money that may be earned. It is perfectly impossible, applying these principles, to avoid making a much larger profit than if profit were the main object. I want to prove it so that all of us may have more, and that all of us may live better by increasing the service rendered by all businesses. Poverty cannot be abolished by formula. It can be abolished only by hard and intelligent work. We are, in effect, an experimental station to prove a principle. That we do make money is only further proof that we are right. For that is a species of argument that establishes itself without words. In the first chapter was set forth the creed. Let me repeat it in the light of the work that has been done under it, for it is the basis of all our work. 1. An absence of fear of the future or veneration for the past. One who fears the future, who fears failure, limits his activities. Failure is only the opportunity more intelligently to begin again. There is no disgrace in honest failure. There is disgrace in fearing to fail. What is past is useful only as it suggests ways and means for progress. 2. A disregard of competition. Whoever does a thing best ought to be the one to do it. It is criminal to try to get business away from another man. Criminal, because one is then trying to lower for personal gain the conditions of one's fellow men, to rule by force instead of by intelligence. 3. The putting of service before profit. Without a profit, business cannot extend. There is nothing inherently wrong about making a profit. Well-conducted business enterprises cannot fail to return a profit, but profit must and inevitably will come as a reward for good service. It cannot be the basis. It must be the result of service. 4. Manufacturing is not buying low and selling high. It is the process of buying materials fairly and, with the smallest possible addition of cost, transforming those materials into a consumable product and distributing it to the consumer. Gambling, speculating, and sharp dealing tend only to clog this progression. We must have production, but it is the spirit behind it that counts most. That kind of production, which is a service, inevitably follows a real desire to be of service. The various wholly artificial rules set up for finance and industry, and which pass as laws, break down with such frequency as to prove that they are not even good guesses. The basis of all economic reasoning is the earth and its products. To make the yield of the earth, in all its forms, large enough and dependable enough to serve as the basis for real life, the life which is more than eating and sleeping, is the highest service. That is the real foundation for an economic system. We can make things. The problem of production has been solved brilliantly. We can make any number of different sorts of things by the millions. The material mode of our life is splendidly provided for. There are enough processes and improvements now pigeonholed and awaiting application to bring the physical side to life to almost millennial completeness. But we are too wrapped up in the things we are doing. We are not enough concerned with the reasons why we do them. Our whole competitive system, our whole creative expression, all the play of our faculties seem to be centered around material production and its byproducts of success and wealth. There is, for instance, a feeling that personal or group benefit can be had at the expense of other persons or groups. There is nothing to be gained by crushing anyone. If the farmer's bloc should crush the manufacturers, would the farmers be better off? If the manufacturer's bloc should crush the farmers, would the manufacturers be better off? Could capital gain by crushing labor, or labor by crushing capital? Or does a man in business gain by crushing a competitor? No, destructive competition benefits no one. The kind of competition which results in the defeat of the many and the overlordship of the ruthless few must go. Destructive competition lacks the qualities out of which progress comes. Progress comes from a generous form of rivalry. Bad competition is personal. It works for the aggrandizement of some individual or group. It is a sort of warfare. It is inspired by a desire to get someone. It is wholly selfish. That is to say, its motive is not pride in the product, nor a desire to excel in service, nor yet a wholesome ambition to approach to scientific methods of production. It is moved simply by the desire to crowd out others and monopolize the market for the sake of the money returns. That being accomplished, it always substitutes a product of inferior quality. Freeing ourselves from the petty sort of destructive competition frees us from many set notions. We are too closely tied to old methods and single one-way uses. We need more mobility. We have been using certain things just one way. We have been sending certain goods through only one channel. And when that use is slack, or that channel is stopped, business stops too, and all the sorry consequences of depression set in. Take corn, for example. There are millions upon millions of bushels of corn stored in the United States with no visible outlet. A certain amount of corn is used as food for man and beast, but not all of it. In pre-Prohibition days, a certain amount of corn went into the making of liquor, which was not a very good use for good corn. But through a long course of years, corn followed those two channels, and when one of them stopped, the stocks of corn began to pile up. It is the money fiction that usually retards the movement of stocks, but even if money were plentiful, we could not possibly consume the stores of food which we sometimes possess. If foodstuffs become too plentiful to be consumed as food, why not find other uses for them? Why use corn only for hogs and distilleries? Why sit down and bemoan the terrible disaster that has befallen the corn market? Is there no use for corn besides the making of pork or the making of whiskey? Surely there must be. There should be so many uses for corn that the only important uses could ever be fully served. There ought always be enough channels open to permit corn to be used without waste. Once upon a time, the farmers burned corn as fuel. Corn was plentiful and coal was scarce. That was a crude way to dispose of corn, but it contained the germ of an idea. There is fuel in corn. Oil and fuel alcohol are obtainable from corn, and it is high time that someone was opening up this new use so that the stored up corn crops may be moved. Why have only one string to our bow? Why not two? If one breaks, there is the other. If the hog business slackens, why should not the farmer turn his corn into tractor fuel? We need more diversity all round. The four-track system everywhere would not be a bad idea. We have a single-track money system. It is a mighty fine system for those who own it. It is a perfect system for the interest-collecting, credit-controlling financiers who literally own the commodity called money and who literally own the machinery by which money is made and used. Let them keep their system if they like it. But the people are finding out that it is a poor system for what we call hard times, because it ties up the line and stops traffic. If there are special protections for the interests, there ought also to be special protections for the plain people. Diversity of outlet, of use, and of financial enablement are the strongest defenses we can have against economic emergencies. It is likewise with labor. There surely ought to be flying squadrons of young men who would be available for emergency conditions in harvest field, mine, shop, or railroad. If the fires of 100 industries threaten to go out for lack of coal, and 1 million men are menaced by unemployment, it would seem both good business and good humanity for a sufficient number of men to volunteer for the mines and the railroads. There is always something to be done in this world, and only ourselves to do it. The whole world may be idle, and in the factory sense, there may be nothing to do. There may be nothing to do in this place or that, but there is always something to do. It is this fact which should urge us to such an organization of ourselves that this something to be done may get done, and unemployment reduced to a minimum. Every advance begins in a small way and with the individual. The mass can be no better than the sum of the individuals. Advancement begins with the man himself, when he advances from half interest to strength of purpose, when he advances from hesitancy to decisive directness, when he advances from immaturity to maturity of judgment, when he advances from apprenticeship to mastery, when he advances from a mere dilettante at labor to a worker who finds a genuine joy in work, and when he advances from an eye server to one who can be entrusted to do his work without oversight and without prodding, why, then the world advances. The advance is not easy. We live in flabby times when men are being taught that everything ought to be easy. Work that amounts to anything will never be easy. And the higher you go in the scale of responsibility, the harder becomes the job. Ease has its place, of course. Every man who works ought to have sufficient leisure. The man who works hard should have his easy chair, his comfortable fireside, his pleasant surroundings. These are his by right. But no one deserves ease until after his work is done. It will never be possible to put upholstered ease into work. Some work is needlessly hard. It can be lightened by proper management. Every device ought to be employed to leave a man free to do a man's work. Flesh and blood should not be made to bear burdens that steel can bear. But even when the best is done, work still remains work, and any man who puts himself into his job will feel that it is work. And there cannot be much picking and choosing. The appointed task may be less than was expected. A man's real work is not always what he would have chosen to do. A man's real work is what he has chosen to do. Just now, there are more menial jobs than there will be in the future. And as long as there are menial jobs, someone will have to do them. But there is no reason why a man should be penalized because his job is menial. There is one thing that can be said about menial jobs that cannot be said about a great many so-called more responsible jobs, and that is, they are useful, and they are respectable, and they are honest. The time has come when drudgery must be taken out of labor. It is not work that men object to, but the element of drudgery. We must drive out drudgery wherever we find it. We shall never be wholly civilized until we remove the treadmill from the daily job. Invention is doing this in some degree now. We have succeeded, to a very great extent, in relieving men of the heavier and more onerous jobs that used to sap their strength. But even when lightening the heavier labor, we have not yet succeeded in removing monotony. That is another field that beckons us, the abolition of monotony, and in trying to accomplish that, we shall doubtless discover other changes that will have to be made in our system. The opportunity to work is now greater than ever it was. The opportunity to advance is greater. It is true that the young man who enters industry today enters a very different system from that in which the young man of 25 years ago began his career. The system has been tightened up. There is less play or friction in it. Fewer matters are left to the haphazard will of the individual. The modern worker finds himself part of an organization which apparently leaves him little initiative. Yet, with all this, it is not true that men are mere machines. It is not true that opportunity has been lost in organization. If the young man will liberate himself from these ideas and regard the system as it is, he will find that what he thought was a barrier is really an aid. Factory organization is not a device to prevent the expansion of ability, but a device to reduce the waste and losses due to mediocrity. It is not a device to hinder the ambitious, clear-headed man from doing his best, but a device to prevent the don't care sort of individual from doing his worst. That is to say, when laziness, carelessness, slothfulness, and lack interest are allowed to have their own way, everybody suffers. The factory cannot prosper and therefore cannot pay living wages when an organization makes it necessary for the don't care class to do better than they naturally would. It is for their benefit. They are better physically, mentally, and financially. What wages should we be able to pay if we trusted a large don't care class to their own methods and gait of production? If the factory system, which brought mediocrity up to a higher standard, operated also to keep ability down to a lower standard, it would be a very bad system indeed. But a system, even a perfect one, must have able individuals to operate it. No system operates itself, and the modern system needs more brains for its operation than did the old. More brains are needed today than ever before, although perhaps they are not needed in the same place as they once were. It is just like power. Formerly, every machine was run by foot power. The power was right at the machine. But nowadays, we have moved the power back, concentrated it in the powerhouse. Thus also, we have made it unnecessary for the highest types of mental ability to be engaged in every operation in the factory. The better brains are in the mental power plant. Every business that is growing is at the same time creating new places for capable men. It cannot help but do so. This does not mean that new openings come every day and in groups. Not at all. They come only after hard work. It is the fellow who can stand the gaff of routine and still keep himself alive and alert who finally gets into direction. It is not sensational brilliance that one seeks in business, but sound, substantial dependability. Big enterprises, of necessity, move slowly and cautiously. The young man with ambition ought to take a long look ahead and leave an ample margin of time for things to happen. A great many things are going to change. We shall learn to be masters rather than servants of nature. With all our fancied skill, we still depend largely on natural resources and think that they cannot be displaced. We dig coal and ore and cut down trees. We use the coal and the ore and they are gone. The trees cannot be replaced within a lifetime. We shall someday harness the heat that is all about us and no longer depend on coal. We may now create heat through electricity generated by water power. We shall improve on that method. As chemistry advances, I feel quite certain that a method will be found to transform growing things into substances that will endure better than the metals. We have scarcely touched the uses of cotton. Better wood can be made than is grown. The spirit of true service will create for us. We have only each of us to do our part sincerely. Everything is possible. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. End of chapter 19. End of My Life and Work by Henry Ford, in collaboration with Samuel Crowther.
Hi, this is Super Utils with some afterbirds. I'm here just to ask, if you enjoyed this audiobook, then please, please do click on the like button down below and subscribe to my channel. Thank you for your time and take care.